Good morning, everyone, and good evening, good afternoon, good night to the people online. Welcome to the F-Secure Capital Markets Day. My name is Tapio Pesola. I'm the Investor Relations Manager here at F-Secure, and we have a busy day for you today, so let's not waste time in the introductions. Okay. I'll quickly run through the program of the day. So first we'll have our CEO Christian going through the company strategy and giving a market update, followed by Saila, who will focus on the financial side. Then we have a brief Q&A space, and then we'll focus on the corporate business, starting with Tomi Tuominen explaining what a cyber attack really is about. And then Pekka and Jens will explain the business side and how we defend customers' companies against attacks. Then we'll have a short break, and after that we focus on consumer security. Samu will explain that, and then after him, Mikko Hyppönen will give you the latest details on threat landscape. And after that we close with our chairman of the board, Risto Siilasmaa, who will give the closing remarks. And then we finish at about 1 o'clock, after which we will have lunch here on location. Some practical issues. As you notice, all the presentations will be in English. And online, I would ask the people to ask their questions using the chat functionality so that then I can read them and give the questions to the presenters. On location, I would ask you to use the microphone. So I will then hand it to you. The presentation should end at about 1 o'clock. And then all the material, of course, will be available online. If there aren't any questions at this time, then just welcome one more time and enjoy the day. And Christian,
yes,
the floor is yours.
All right, thank you. And good morning on my behalf as well. And welcome everybody online. It's great to have you here, Capital Markets Day. We thought that we haven't had it actually. This is the first time for as long as I have been, soon 4 years as the CEO. So we thought that maybe it's about time. And also, we have done so many changes, so we felt that it is important also to tell a bit about the logic behind it and also explain more when we talk about advanced threats and going to enterprises. What does that mean? And how do we intend to move in there? And why do we believe that we can and will differentiate in that market as well as we continue keeping the other channels that we are going? And in a way, this is also about deep expertise for us. We believe we're a hardcore security company. We fight for digital freedom. Our work matters. It matters for corporations. It matters for consumers. And we want to be the company that is so well recognized for its expertise that who do you call when you get hit? When you get really in deep trouble? We will find things nobody else does. And we will have less false alarms than anybody else in the industry. We believe that that is the combination of what we have that we can accomplish. Let me run through the history a bit first, that what have we done so far. So a while ago, as you have known, we have had the challenges with the PC security. That's no surprise to you. As has the same thing happened with the market, and the growth through the operator channel in our consumer business stalled. And that led us, of course, to do different things. And one of them was to look at the corporate business, which has been more for the SMB market, which is selling through resellers. And we started investing in corporate sales and our products in selected growth markets. Here we mentioned the biggest ones, Germany and France, which are going well for us now. So that work is bearing fruit for us, and it is having impact in terms of our top line and in terms of our growth of the new products in the corporate space. Then we also wanted to get more exciting as a company and launch more products. And one of them, of course, has been Freedom, which gels well, trying to find new categories in the consumer markets, not only being in a PC security or all devices security, as you know. And Freedom for us is a great new example of a category where we try to find new ways of doing value added, both directly with consumers as well as then through the operators. in terms of our focus, we realized also that we needed to exit some parts of business, because if you just add on, that doesn't it's not a very focused way of doing things. So we also then sold in February, as you know, we sold the United or the storage business as we have it to Synchronos. And that was a way for us to exit and get more strong in terms of our next phase, which was then actually going into expanding into enterprise and entry into true cybersecurity. And I will run through more of the logic, and you will hear today, of course, from the cybersecurity services team as well, a bit about what it means and what we are capable of doing in a combined entity. And I truly believe that in this entity, when we have services, when we have people, consultants, and the product and the security from the cloud elements, we actually, in a combined way, 1 + 1 = 3. I truly believe so, and I believe that that is a strong offering that we will be able to bring to the markets already in the first half of next year. Let me explain a bit on the business model, which actually relates to the other presentations that you will see today as well, and why we are structured the way we are. So we will have two strong legs. One is the consumer security business, and the other one is the corporate security business. A lot of the same engines are behind this. There is differences, and I'll explain some of it when we go ahead, but a lot of the same engines are behind, so it makes sense for us to go to consumer with tens of millions of customers, where the threat landscape is not as advanced as in some of the SMBs, where of course the most and heaviest threat landscape, most advanced threats are happening in the large enterprises, where we have hundreds of customers, whereas in the SMBs you have tens of thousands. In the corporate security, we both sell now through resellers, where we have about 4,000 plus resellers, and we are expanding on that, expanding through the markets, especially looking at Europe. And we of course do now, with the acquisition of Ensense and going into large enterprises, we now have hundreds of customers in direct sales with enterprises as well. Also looking mainly at now at the moment in Nordics, and then looking at advancing into European countries as well. Consumer security, we then also have the same situation. So we sell our security products through operators, which are consumer products, and then direct sales as well, which we do mainly actually in the Nordics, if you look at the actual business for us, whereas the operator is a global action. Let me just give you a picture of where what's happening and why it is also interesting for us to expand in the different markets. So we're not only looking at technology, but where do we go in terms of the channel, and why it is interesting for us to go from consumer to SMB to enterprise, and cover those with same kind of technology tools, even if you need certain things and elements more in the enterprise side. Consumer security software is expected to grow 4 to 5% annually. Of course, that's the overall market, but within that market, it is very flattish or slight decline, the basic PC security market. Whereas there are new categories such as privacy and others which are adding to the, so that also the consumer security has growth, but the biggest growth comes from these new advanced portions in that market, not from the old PC security. So it is in the other space that growth happens in. In corporate security market, we see 6 to 7% growth annually. And we believe we can grow faster than the market in our corporate business as well. Now, enterprise security is the fastest growing, with 8.5% growth globally year on year, and Europe is expected to grow 7.6% year in the enterprise market. It is slightly slower than the global, where the biggest growth in the global terms is, of course, United States. US is a lot of the enterprise growth at the moment, and we believe that Europe is coming behind, but it is also picking up in terms of enterprises and governments waking up with the challenges that they have with the advanced threats. And there is not a boardroom who is not waking up at the moment all across Europe. And there is also a political understanding that the question is, who do you call, who do you trust? Because you do know that there are political biases at the moment, depending on which country you come from. Whether you come from China, from Russia, from United States, or any of the bigger countries. Not because the companies are bad, they're all good companies, but they have different frame in terms of the way they work with the governments in their countries. Now, if we then look at ourselves, right, so we have our base. And if I look at, I'm going to concentrate now a bit more on the latest acquisition and moving into enterprise. Not even if that is the smallest portion of our business today. And then Samu will cover a lot more about consumer security, which remains with the operator channel an extremely important. It is still half of the business that we do is through operator channel. It is and it will remain an important part for us. And it's important for us to launch new product into the consumer segment. We see interesting parts in this consumer space. So investing in PC security, that's not the case, right? That's not what drives anybody excited at the moment, even if you need to have that as a bread and butter for that business. Doing the multi-device is the same thing. We're rolling it out. About half of our operators, roughly half of the operators now have our multi-device solution in the operator space. But there are a couple, at least when it comes to the emerging new markets in the consumer space, which someone will talk from the consumer security more than about, is the digital home. How do we solve the digital home and the privacy, which is raising its head more and more, where we have, of course, freedom as a product category. And then, of course, digital home, where we have no solution out in the market as of yet. But we find it a very thrilling and exciting point, both in terms of getting using the operator channel as well as the consumer directly. But it is an interesting space. Basically, it's about the Internet of Home, when you will have more and more connected devices in your home, and there will be no business in security to sell an application to each and one of those devices. And it is not because those devices are interesting in itself. We used this term before as well. That it does, nobody wants to hack your fridge to make you buy a little bit more milk, right? That's not interesting for anybody. But it is an interesting entry point into your network, because it will be all of them connected to your Wi-Fi. And we need to find a way to solve that. And we believe that's something that with our capabilities and innovation skills, that's something that we should be able to solve in this industry. When it comes to the corporate business, we see a good growth and we believe we can grow faster in the market in the corporate security area, which is going towards the SMBs, which is going through resellers. We know now that we can do it. We have a repeatable business that we can run, and we can see that our product is well received with the resellers. It is a good offering that we have on the table, and Pekka will run through that for you as well a bit more. So you understand why we believe this is a good place for us to be. And now I will talk a little bit more about the cybersecurity services, as it is the biggest growth potential as a market, even if it is the smallest number for us right now. But there are a few reasons, and that's I wanted to run through this logic for you so you understand why we actually took that step to go into enterprise. It was a conscious decision, so why did you do that? So how does the cyber services and that space support our business? Now, as I said before, when we came out with the acquisition, we do not intend to become a headcount shopping company. We intend to be a hardcore security company. We will not be a general consulting company on your processes and so forth, but we want to be the hardcore, the go-to people. Who do you call when you really are in trouble? And who has the skill sets to find something when nobody else does, and who have the least possible false alarms, which basically is killing some of the business now because the enterprises get so much alarm, so it's very hard to react to it anymore. So there's two reasons basically for why we felt, to summarize these two reasons, I will run through them. There is clearly, and this is what you know, I don't have to, you will hear more about it today as well, but the threat landscape is such that there is a lot of demand for services in the enterprise segment. I don't think there is a border CXO level people who haven't woken up now, also in Europe, in terms of what is the risk that you as a company face. It is millions, tens or even hundreds of millions of damages versus reputational loss versus people getting even, you know, CEOs fired even. And, you know, CEOs get scared of that, of course. And so there is a clear point that that is where there is a growth potential, where there's a lot of need, and we can sense that and see that already with the cybersecurity services, which Jens and Tommy will talk about in terms of what it means. So what are the main problems in that space, which leads to soaring financial and other damages? So we know now that the cyber attacks are growing fast. It is a huge growth number. It is a lucrative business. It is a return on investments, which is over 1,000% for the hackers, for the criminals. And of course, there is IPR issues and innovation that you can do when it comes to stealing or understanding the most innovative patents that you have. So the information is a lot of power as well. The second point in this and the problem is that the attacks are getting through because they are advanced. Advanced persistent threat. That's what it means. They are advanced, they're persistent, they have a lot of capabilities, they have a lot of financing to keep on trying. And it is, of course, very skillfully done. You'll understand a bit more today what do we mean with that and how do we believe that we can find things when nobody else does and we can block better than anybody else does. And at the end of it, in hardcore security business, that's what matters. When you end up in trouble, you don't want the average person to come to your company to save you or find what it is. You want the real hardcore people who are capable of finding things, right? That is a big, you can't market yourself. You can't do a marketing campaign to get you out of the fact that the toughest knowledge is also where it is. Also, to retain talent, it is important to be that kind of company that people want to be in. It is also very clear as another problem that it takes way too long to detect and respond. It can take years, which is scary for when you think about it. And we have so many examples now. It's almost getting diluted because these examples are hitting us every day. Ashley Madison, you just know, right? And so forth, right? I'm not going to get into this one now because we have Tommy and Mikko and the other guys today who will explain you more about the threat landscape. I just showed you a couple examples which are here just lately, where a security contractor in US is a similar attack to previous done from China, and this took the damages in that one was to hundreds of millions in the 25,000 employees. The Homeland Security Department cost them hundreds of millions. That's one hack. And then, of course, the New York Health Insurer, which has hacked with 10 million members, possibly hacked. And this was recognized last month in August. They found it. And it had been there at least for 2 years. For 2 years. And this is coming over and over again. So this is the skills of advanced threats. And that's incredible that somebody's inside for 2 years. So once you get through, it's very little capabilities in the industry to actually find them when they are therein and find them and respond fast. And that is a capability that we believe we can bring to the market. So second reason why we went to this business, why we thought that this is a good way for us to expand, is of course that if you want to be a hardcore security company, the one who you call, and people kept calling us, by the way, and have kept calling us, kept calling us because we have the labs. We have had the labs capabilities, one of the few in Europe, one of the strongest in the world. We believe we are second to nobody in that part, but we had no business to sell to anybody. So we got the calls and we were helping out people. We're getting requests. We're part of the investigations, but we did not have business to do in that space. So obviously it is a smart thing, typical in business, to go where business is and where people keep calling you and asking you to help them. So it makes sense to why don't we actually start charging for it and make a business out of it, because we get this call and instead of just deflecting those calls to somebody else if we can't take them. And you want to be as a real hardcore security company, you want to be where the most advanced attacks are. And you want to learn and find and build that capability into the machinery. So we believe, and I'll show you why we believe that after the post-acquisition, will we have 1 plus 1 becoming 3? Why will this be even a better and we believe we will bring new innovation to this market. We will take a position which truly belongs to us as well with the capabilities. We will merge men and machines, and it will be a new way of doing things that enterprises have not seen when it comes to doing artificial intelligence and combining this skill set. So let me explain you how this we believe what we will do. So we have in the middle here, you see the security cloud, which we have, of course, been running. We take 300 samples a day that we analyze with our artificial intelligence, with our heuristic systems. We take over 3 billion reputation queries per day. This is a machine that has been built over a long time. It is connected to many places and gets a lot of analysis done together with our labs. This is the F-Secure research team, which are working on it. It's part of Samu, when he explains about the consumer business, which supports the whole company. Now, of course, we will also build a device and perimeter sensor. So what we will launch in the first half of next year will be our solution into the advanced threat market, into enterprises, which will be kind of an alarm system. Jens will explain a bit more how they work with this, but it will be an alarm system in a way for enterprises that, as I said already earlier, it will find attacks that nobody else does, and it will have less false alarms than anybody else has. We believe we are very advanced when it comes to this capability now. So it will have sensors inside of the enterprise, and we will sense actually when somebody's doing something, when somebody's inside, even if you have gone through our preventive measures. And then we will have, of course, ourselves now, the cybersecurity experts. So these are already taking new incidents now every week. We're taking new incidents of advanced threats. These will be hardcore experts which are capable to respond, rapid response teams. So not only will we sense and know with our new tools and products what's happening, but we will also be able to do forensic and help you actually clean it and understand who was behind it. So in a way, what you will end up with is, if I go back to the original slide with consumer security and corporate security, but we will have the same security cloud that feeds or is behind all of us offering. And when we get in consumers and SMBs and large enterprises the most advanced attacks, all of this will make our capabilities better all the time. And of course, when we get more and more sensors out there into enterprises, our skill sets will increase. And we are, of course, then going to have to go into this high demand market with the solution. So what kind of offering will we then do? You will see this more, so I'm not going to get into this one a lot now, because this is what then the other business heads will explain to you. Basically, what when someone goes through consumer security, what are we doing when it comes to security and privacy, and what are we doing in corporate security now in terms of the SMB market when it comes to prevent and detect. We will drive our solutions through resellers in an automated way for scalability. And in the enterprise segment, we will have the capability to predict, prevent, detect, and respond, as I said, the whole enchilada, so to say. And that we will do together with services into the large businesses, large enterprises only. And all of this is fed by the same machine, and we will have the services part only with the large enterprises, and we will use resellers and actually also look at using partners then in the enterprise to drive scalability and products and services as the primary way. So this is the offering today. You will hear it soon from the other guys. And when it comes to consumer, SMB, and now the large enterprise segment, and looking ahead into 2016, we're looking at how do we protect the digital home, what do we need to do in that space, and how do we get out now with the new advanced threat protection product and solution overall in the next year. So, to put this in a summary, we have refined the company strategy during 2015, quite big shift for us into hardcore security, fighting for digital freedom. We refocus our company then into security products and services, but we will drive for scalability. We have exited non-cloud non-core cloud storage business, and we have laid the foundation now for cybersecurity strategy going forward as a company and repositioning ourselves also much broader in the security space for us through these different channels. And we will continue in 2016-17 investing into these higher growth areas, manage corporate security, cybersecurity, and we will bring and utilize the great channel we have with the operators through our consumer security offering. And we will drive scale, we will drive efficiency through the same back-end systems. We do not want to have a hugely different offering throughout this, but we will bring better capabilities to the higher end of the enterprise market. But that skill sets will drive our systems throughout the SMB and the consumer market. And we're looking then at possible acquisitions, but also just normal organic growth as well in terms of these new business areas for us. Just last comment on the countries we are looking at. So in the corporate business, in the corporate security business, our focus is on Europe. We believe that that's where we have the best reach, the best capability, and the best brand in terms of also having the cybersecurity services, and the reseller channel is here. Whereas globally, we will continue with consumer security business through the operator, which is actually the reason why we are global, of course. We reach still and continue to reach. Even if the business is flat for us or declined -2% in the last quarter, we reach close to 1.5 billion subscribers in the operator base. I realize that that's not something we have been able to sell products so far, but we are not forgetting when it comes to digital home that that remains a great opportunity for us if we can innovate in that scale. So that's the summary on my part before we go into more details from the different businesses. Once again, the operator channel continues to be important. And we see new exciting consumer segments there. Someone will tell about those. We see good growth opportunities and traction in the corporate security, and also the biggest growth opportunity for us in the enterprise arena for us. And the newly acquired cybersecurity services is a great match. I believe 1+1 gives us the opportunity to launch new products. It becomes 3 when you put together the F-Secure Labs, the cybersecurity services, and our whole back engine that we have. And we will continue using the channels that we have capable, and we aim for European cybersecurity leadership with these actions. We believe we are the one that can take that trusted position. It's a great opportunity for us as a company to step forward. And that's it from me, and a good start for the day for us. And I think Tapio Saila will be next, right?
Thank you, Christian. And now let's continue with Saila. In the meantime, while she's coming, I'm just apologize that we have some printouts still missing, but they are coming very soon, so don't worry about that. So anyway, Saila, financials.
Thank you. And indeed, technology company having technology problems with something as simple as prints, but indeed, they're on their way. And as far as the financial updates, unfortunately, we're in the time zone when I can't tell you a whole lot of new. The Q3 is up and coming in a few weeks' time. And then again, it's still a bit early to jump into guiding you in as far as what happens next year. So that will have to wait. But this is, that said, a brief recap into what has been in the past and what the trends are that we can see underlying the financial development that we've seen over the last year or two. That said, obviously this is probably very familiar to all of you. We're ticking a steady 36 million revenues per quarter. This is restated after the disposal of the cloud storage business. And similarly, we're ticking a steady EBIT of say 4 to 7 million per quarter, ticking around say 15% of revenues. So you might ask, well, okay, what else is new? That said, there is nothing very new in this picture. Obviously, we want to improve on that in terms of the revenue growth and hopefully also do it profitably in the future. But All that said, that's where we are. We have been for the last couple of years. And yes, reiterating our guidance for the full year of this year, i.e., we intend to improve at least a bit on the growth figure and be above at least at 5% or above for the full year and keep the EBIT at a healthy around 15%. But as said, underlying and hiding kind of behind the steady behavior of the revenue stream over the last couple of years, there's a very clear trend in our business in terms of what's actually happening below the surface. And that's where you can see that indeed our operator business, which was still in the first quarter of 2014 at 62%, is now 52%. And at the operator and direct business, having been at 38%, is now almost on equal footing to the operator business at 48%. And this clearly reveals to you the fact that, as Christian also mentioned, the operator business has been fairly steady, even in slight decline, quarter on quarter, depending also on the FX rates and the volatility over there. But given that the overall revenue has been remained steady, then clearly the up and coming corporate business as well as the direct business, which are both enjoying healthy growth, are catching up. And again, with the cybersecurity coming to beef the corporate side off, then this is the growth trend that we're seeing and pursuing going forward. But as Christian also mentioned, this is not something that we should forget. It's a steady, good business, profitable business for us. And we're keeping this very much alive and also pursuing this. But this is, again, something that should be remembered going forward. And I'll make one forward-looking statement in terms of reporting revenue. We are currently preparing to start reporting the revenue line slightly differently starting next year, meaning that now that the corporate business and consumer business are probably the more relevant distinction between our two revenue lines rather than operator versus a combination of corporate and direct business, then starting next year, our intention is to start reporting the revenue in consumer business on one hand and corporate business on the other, which I hope you will find beneficial in terms of understanding what actually is going on and happening. In terms of where does the revenue come from? And this is actually a reflection of what Christian showed you on the map. And whilst it is true that the corporate business primarily is centered in Europe, you can still see that our North American and the rest of the world, for example, Latin America business, is growing, relatively speaking, to the European and Nordic business. And that, again, is largely thanks to the growing operator business in those faraway markets, whereas the operator business here in Europe is fairly flat and mature, we're still seeing nice growth in the, for example, Latin America. And that shows in here. This may not have to be a permanent picture in view of the fact that indeed we're focusing fairly heavily on the European business on the corporate side, but still, this is telling the picture that we are a global operator. And that is what we keep on doing as well. In terms of costs, those two, reflecting the fairly flat top line and fairly flat EBIT line, have not changed dramatically either. But what you can see here as a trend, the bottom part of the bars reflects sales and marketing costs. And that indeed goes to show that, yes, whilst we've kept the overall profitability of the company at a very stellar level, we have still built businesses by investing more heavily in sales and marketing in the pursuit of keeping the growth up and increasing the growth going forward. And that, I would think that is a trend also going forward. In terms of generating growth, we understand that we need to keep the sales and marketing at a healthy level. But that said, the likely scenario going forward is that we still want to keep the profitability at a reasonable level as well. R&D is another important factor, obviously, in a business that is very fast changing, technology is developing. We need to keep that at a healthy level to generate the new features into our products that keep the prices up, keep the market shares up, and also keep the innovation at a level that we can then bring also very altogether new products to the markets and our clients. One thing that is or has been interesting to note recently is that clearly the whole security markets and all the cyber attacks that receive very much attention in the global media is a very global phenomenon. And that said, that also shows in the trading of security shares. And in our case too, whilst I think we can still pursue a better liquidity for the share, that is certainly in our hopes going forward, we're seeing an increasing interest from around the world, and I'd say particularly from the US. Many of you may have noticed that there's a US security focused ETF that has been investing the share. They flagged having reached over 5% of our shareholding in July, and since then have been hovering around, say, 6 to 7% holding. But beyond that particular ETF, we're also seeing quite a sort of increasing number of calls, requests, questions coming from a fairly large variety of US investors, as well as some European. And I think that, in part, reflects, like I said, the growing interest in the field in general from the investor community, but also to an extent probably the fact that compared to the US market, the valuations in Europe are by and large quite a bit lower. So that in terms of F-Secure, probably some other our competitors as well, presents a good opportunity for them. But overall, as said, we've seen a fairly healthy increase in the international holding in our share. So sort of summing up, something that will again be discussed in more detail by my colleagues going forward, kind of the investment case for F-Secure, where are we, what should we be looking for? Obviously we operate in a growing market. We're now moving into an era which is clearly beyond the traditional antivirus, but we do believe that we're well equipped to attack that market as well. We have the best-in-class technology, a broad technology base, which was yet further broadened by the acquisition of Ensense, and also our own work in that channel. We have two proven channels, or actually many proven channels, to support the growth on two legs, meaning that we are building the business on the corporate side as well as then on the consumer side, and those support our growth going forward. Solid financials, obviously throughout the history we've been profitable. We have a very strong cash position at the moment, and I wonder what happened to our cash slide. We're missing a slide from here. Point being that obviously our balance sheet is in a very healthy state. We had more than 110 million in cash at the end of Q1. We still had paid dividends, paid cash consideration for Ensense. We still had 76 million at the end of Q2 and no debt, which means that if we look into how do we go forward, we have what it takes in terms of balance sheet to go for further acquisitions, grow by investing ourselves, and grow by potentially acquiring other players in the field. And yes, our strategy, which has been published last year, states that we aim for double-digit growth by the end of the strategy period of 2015-2017, and that is something that we do maintain. And that's basically where I would leave it. And for questions then for Christian, and if there's something for myself.
Yes. So now is the first questions and answers section. So if any of you have any questions, then now is the chance to voice them out, and I'll then bring you the microphone. Yes.
Thank you. Raul Etelmäki from Danske Bank. Since the cybersecurity is becoming such an important part of your business, are you going to report that revenue for the company as well?
We haven't decided on that level yet. At the moment, we, as Sala said, we would look at the it's small, by the way, to start with in that perspective. But we will look at first from the whole corporate business and the consumer business. I think that's a very relevant question, and happy to hear comments on it on the breaks as well, that how important that is. But I think that we would then, when we get going forward a bit, I'm sure we would, but not in the beginning now. That's the thinking.
Yeah. Then I had another question on FX. Has the recent volatility in euro against the emerging market currencies, how does that impact your revenue and your expenses?
Obviously, we are generating also a fair bit of the expenses in the said countries where, for example, the developing countries' currencies generate their revenue. That said, the total impact could reach, I'd say, on an annual level into maybe some single millions, but not beyond that. And we are, I'd say, we're not a very aggressive hedger of FX, but we obviously do some of that to decrease the volatility and the FX impact.
Mikael Rautanen, Inderes. One question for Christian.
Sure.
About the competition in the corporate sector. So how do you see the large system integrators in the competition? We have seen companies like CGI saying that they are eager to get into this business and looking for acquisition targets. Are they competitors or potential partners for you?
I suppose more partners. I think that the way we will, the way we have positioned ourselves, I don't see some of these really big integrators as direct competitors. They have a broader offering of many different things, right? And we will be very hardcore in the security space. I think our skill sets will be far more advanced than anybody of those will be capable of as such in that our own space. And I think that we will definitely see many of them as partners for us as an option, right? We call them the MSPs, right? And that we could use also in terms of getting more scale. As you know, getting into big enterprises is also in direct business, direct sales, an own challenge in itself. So, and we have now hundreds of customers in enterprise as well, and you'll hear more from Jens, but that's a clear option as partners. So partners mainly than competitors, I would say.
An additional question, what about consulting companies, big four consulting companies? They are also willing to get into this space. What kind of weaknesses or strengths do those players have?
Yeah, I think they have their own strengths, of course. And as I said, we don't even aim to be one of those big consulting companies. I think there's a big difference between consulting in security space and being capable of doing so, and they have their capabilities as well. But they will be still on, as we see it, on a higher level when it comes to you know, the processes, the different standards, the way of looking at the whole IT systems and how you run the whole process. It's a very different kind of consulting when our guys actually are the guys who go into the machine rooms. They go into the systems, right? We are, with our labs and the research items, I think we are more, we will be much more hardcore, much more capable, as well as I believe we can retain that kind of talent with our kind of heart. It is also a question, who do you go to as if you're a talented guy in that space, and it takes a long time to become so talented. And I think that that's why we will be a bit different from them.
Kimmo Stenvall, Pohjola. About the corporate market, which is now the core or the new focus area for F-Secure, how do you see the scalability of the business model going forward?
Yeah, I think that's why we, of course, look at more Europe, because I think from a brand and from a reach perspective, it's easier for us. So from scalability, I think in the two things, in the SMB market, we will go with products and we will not bring people into it. So we will go through resellers. And that's with the 4,000 plus that we already have, we're expanding on the resellers. I think we know the formula how to do that profitably. Then in the enterprise segments, we will go both direct, but we will take some of the bigger markets in Europe first with the Nordics included, right? Because I realized that building that, you need to decide which markets to go for, because I think that's exactly the relevant question. How can we scale that with our own sales force? And at the same time, we will look at partnerships then as well in this one to who to work with to bring that faster into the market. I think that's the way we see it. We believe you can do profitable business in both the SMB and the enterprise with the same back engine.
Okay, thanks. And then on the additional question, you flagged some kind of M&A also going forward. What kind of shortage do you have now in your offering? What are you planning? What is the gap now?
Well, I think we have a lot of the product in itself, and as I said, we believe we can launch a lot of the actual solution in the first half next year. We will have the solution out for the enterprises as well. I think you could say that one clear gap is at the moment with the cybersecurity services unit. We have a lot more demand in what we can supply right now, a lot more. It's a good problem, but it's a sad problem in a way, because we need much more talent. So we're looking, because we are not looking at generalists, we're not looking for average skills, but really hardcore skills in that space. So that's one item. And then we might look at certain smaller technology components that if we see and when we see that it makes sense. You don't have to do everything yourself, but you can also partner. So it's not a must for us to move in M&A in that space. We don't want to make deals just to make deals and get crazy about spending the money we have just made for us in the cash, right? That's not the... We don't want to do stupid deals. So we want to stay hardcore.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks.
Sami Sarkamies, Nordea Markets. I have a question on the operator channel that you touched upon and stressed the importance. Should we assume a continued erosion or do you plan to turn it back to growth with new products, and what could be timeline for that? Thanks.
I think the idea we have, of course, is that I don't think we can do growth in that channel with anything which is related to the normal PC security and all of that. I don't think you can run with that. I think we tried for so long, and the market just is not going in that space. But I think that we can with new products. Work on keeping it at least flattish, and then of course it is an upside for us if we can solve the home security and the digital home in a way which actually, because that channel is great in that perspective, that's what the operators know and that's what we together want to solve. So I don't want to make promises because that would be stupid right now, but of course flattish at least, and then looking at how do we find some of the solutions, but they will be new solutions that you can bring in that channel for growth actually.
Okay, we have time for a couple more.
Thank you. Artem Beleski, SEB. Maybe coming back to Kimmo's question about scalability of corporate business. So could you maybe talk about your pricing models within enterprises? So is it man hours what you're selling, or how do you work there?
Yeah, I think so far the business model we're thinking, what we want to do is we don't want to be in man hours as such. I think there is when it comes to man hours, there is almost a price before and after. And man hours after are much more expensive than before in this kind of business. You know, it's kind of like you call the fire brigade after your, or you call the insurance company after your house is burning. It's going to be a lot more expensive in terms of the after. But we would rather sell a solution now, which will include the products, the sensors, the back engine capabilities, you having that capabilities and a rapid response team with it, right? So there's a service that we sell, like we are selling the SaaS service in the SMB market. So that's more the way we believe the enterprises would want it. And not only that you bring them the products, that's the reason why we actually went to bought Ensense, was that we believe there is a need for that kind of service overall, not only selling a product separately. That's not what it's too complex an industry actually for the enterprises as well. So that would be the primary way to go in that market, and which is recurring revenues for you as well at the same time.
And maybe still on scalability, looking at, you talk about a lot about digital home and if you look at current estimates, also number of connected devices will be reaching 25 to 50 billion by 2020, according to some estimates. How are you able to leverage or benefit out of this kind of massive evolution in terms of...
That's what we want to jump on, right? And that's what I believe the operators are also interested about solving. And I think that we have to solve that. I don't want to jump the gun in terms of what we can do in that space, but we want to solve that dilemma so that you basically, we don't want the consumer or the household to need to think about is that or this device or that is protected or not, but you are safe in your home as well as you when you move around with all your devices. That's the logic that we need to have to solve it. And you don't have to think about that I need to take this into account as well or that fridge into account or so forth out of all those devices. If we don't solve that, then we have not been able to do that business at all. It will not fly, I believe so. That's maybe a dwindling answer, not giving it directly how we're going to solve it, but we believe we can solve it. But we will have to make it happen for ourselves and get back to you when we have it. That's something we have been working on for quite a while now.
Right. Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. I think anyone else after? Okay.
Mikael Inderes again. Yep. So in the consumer business, you obviously have good relations with the operators. So is that something that you could leverage in serving the SMB sector?
We have some operators, yes, that are also using our SMB offering. And that's true, they can be a reseller also. We have that offering is already there and it's always for the operators to take. There's a big difference between the operators. Some operators are very consumer focused in their own business models. Some of them have started to do, they do some with SMB, but not that much. But some operators, yes, are clearly more interested. And some of the operators actually are even moving into enterprise, not only providing telecoms, which they've done, of course, all the time, but actually moving into more kind of system integration and system capability, managed services as well, some of the operators. So obviously those are both interesting for us in terms of the SMB offering, as well as the enterprise offering as a channel. The enterprise offering we have not even discussed with them yet, but I know that there is some interest at Lean. But it depends very different between operators, as I said. If you go to Latin America, they're just very consumer focused, for example, and so are many operators in Europe. We will anyhow be mostly in Europe with that focus.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Okay, one final question from Matti, and then we go on.
Yeah, ciao Matti.
Hello, Matti Riikonen, Carnegie. One question about M&A and the valuations in the sector. So you mentioned that in your toolbox you would be using M&A as a way to grow as so far. But how do you think about the valuations in the sector regarding yourself as a buyer? What do you think that is there good companies to be bought at decent valuations or
are they too expensive?
How do you feel?
I think there are probably more in Europe. I think in the US market, the valuations are very high. I don't think our cash will take us anywhere if you go and buy in the US market. I think in Europe there are. It is so that we need to pinpoint those places where we go in the key markets where we go. But as I said, we're not going to rush into it. We can also do organic. We can do it other ways. So, but we are all the time looking. We have a funnel. We're looking at what is there, and we're looking cautiously on the valuation. We don't want to do stupid things there either. I realize that when it gets too hyped, then it doesn't make sense either. And the valuations are where it makes sense for us are in the same ballpark in terms of what we done now earlier. I think that's the kind of valuation level if you want a figure of what we are thinking about in terms of valuations, where it makes sense for us. Also looking at our own valuation. And when you look at that number, then you realize that many of the companies in US are not on that screen at all.
Okay. Thank you for the lively discussion. We can continue that during the coffee break and then during the following Q&As. Thank you, Christian and Saila. And now we'll go on to the corporate business, which seems to be of interest to the crowd as well. And we'll continue with the most interesting part of that, which is the cyber attacks. And Tommy, please, you now have some extra time even, so please use it wisely.
I will. Good morning, everybody. Nice to see you all here. My name is Tomi Tuominen, and I work for the cybersecurity services here at DevSecure. And I'm here to talk about targeted attacks. And when I was asked to deliver this talk, I was kind of wondering how to actually make it a bit more concrete, because this is actually a pretty difficult topic to cover. And I do realize that all of you don't spend your daytime looking at disassemblers and such stuff. So I ended up illustrating it through one picture, which is not this one, it's the next one. But trying to cover or actually make a case why we think that we are entitled to talk about this is that during the last 3 years, we have done more than 100 assignments investigating incidents. And one of my favorite sayings is that for every complex problem, there is a solution that is simple, clean, and wrong. So in order to understand what kind of solution you're coming up with, you first need to understand the problem. And I decided to illustrate it like this. Here on the left-hand side, you have the attacker's environment or ecosystem, if you will. Well, just for the sake of discussion, we will call it Vladimir's side. And on the right-hand side, we have the victim company who's being targeted, be it corporate espionage or whatever. The attack starts by doing some recon. So, you know, out there is this cold frontier called internet. Alexei and Vladimir, they do both some recon operations. They do some social media scavenging. They are going through different resources to find out as much as possible of the from the target organization or the organization that they are targeting. And they're also reading through the web pages that people have out there, and also the social media, Twitter, LinkedIn. And the idea is to build a rough understanding of the business model of the target and also the organizational structure. And it can also go into a more technical stuff as well. But as an end result, they will have a list of targets that they will send their love to. So in this case, they chose 3 employees from the target organization. Our statistics tell us that roughly 30% of the people that are being targeted this way actually open up what's being sent to them. And typically that contains a link to a site that we call a watering hole. Watering hole is a fancy term for any site that the victim organization uses in their daily business. So if you're into, let's say, wind turbines, possibly you're going through a wind turbine part manufacturer's site, or if you're in the media business, it might be a competitor's media pages, or if you're dealing with investor relations, it might be stocks information or something related to that. But it's a harmless site that has been taken over by Vladimir. And he has infected that so that when this one guy on the right-hand side visits that site with his web browser, he's being infected and his computer is being taken over. Now, once that computer has been taken over, or the web browsing experience has been taken over, Vladimir delivers his attack payload to this computer here and effectively is able to control that computer using his command and control infrastructure. After that, during his morning paper, he is being notified that he has actually received one of his targets that he considers a high value target has been infected with his national utility toolkit. After that, he's taking even more control over the environment and uploading his attack toolkit there. Now, this first stage, when during the exploitation, his computer was already taken over, it was already compromised. But because the bad guys, they also want to protect their operational security, now when they find out that, okay, now they have infected the person that they wanted to infect, now they are uploading more utility software to their computer that gives them even more capabilities. Capabilities like logging keystrokes, sharing screen over the internet, storing confidential data in an encrypted fashion, and so on. So after that starts a phase called lateral movement, and it's a fancy term for gaining even more footprint on the victim or organization. So Vladimir is taking over different computers on the organization, and usually it stops when they are finding the right target, which in many cases means the IT administrator. If you have, I suspect that all of you have been reading the Snowden leaks as your daily routine. So even NSA is doing that as well. They are hunting sysadmins as well. And the rationale for doing that is actually pretty simple. They already have the keys to the kingdom. You don't have to take over any computers if you're a sysadmin, because you already have the credentials to do so. That's how skilled attackers work, because now at this stage, Vladimir can control this computer and start data collection from all the servers using the credentials from the sysadmins. And I can tell you that this, in order to spot this kind of activity, requires a huge maturity level on the victim's side. We've seen cases where we have sat down with the sysadmin asking that, was this connection something that you made at this day? Most of us, we can hardly remember our first name, so it can be pretty difficult to remember what you did 2 years ago at that given day. And if you don't have systems to take care of that kind of things, or those kind of things, you're pretty much on your own. Well, after that, the data has been collected. Starts a phase called data exfiltration. Now Vladimir has collected all the important information from there, and then starts moving those containers that hold this confidential information from one machine to another one, and finally the data is being data exfiltrated to his server that he controls, and he's being notified about that. And to give you some ideas how complicated these data exfiltration paths can be, this is from a real case where the first hop was in US, the second hop where this confidential data was moved or transferred to in encrypted form was somewhere in India, the third one in Europe, and then it was sent to a satellite link. Now the attackers don't control the satellite link, but they are able to use it for their advantage. Why satellite link? Because those satellites, they broadcast the information to a roughly 1 million square meter area, and you can be anywhere there to receive that. So a second insight here would be that attribution can be extremely difficult. We have seen cases where people tend to have a die and roll the die, and it doesn't matter what it says, eventually the answer is China. That is not right. We have seen in many cases that the attackers have been completely different motivations, and they were definitely not from China. And this is not to say that some of the attackers most definitely are from China. This is more to say that they are not the only ones doing this. And also, also people tend to think that these kind of attacks are targeting defense contractors and governmental entities and so on. We have seen these kind of attacks targeting gaming industry, banking and finance, big integrators, ISPs. So the toolkits that are out there, you can already know by some of them in a crime as a service format. So you don't have to have your own expertise. This business model actually allows you to buy these sophisticated toolkits and operate them with very, very little technical knowledge. So if we are considering what just happened for Vladimir, it's victory. But if we take a more closer look of this setup, the whole attack is actually formed from these six different stages. And so far, the effort has been that the good guys have been concentrating on stopping the recon and exploitation phases. The way I see it, or we see it in a more broader sense, is that it's actually pretty, first of all, it's impossible to stop recon. And it's kind of difficult to stop exploitation and attack kit delivery phases as well. But the more down you go on the list, the better your chances as a defender become, because these are the things that you actually control as a defender. So if we change the view here, we concentrate more on the detection side and then on our ability to respond. The picture becomes a different one. There are actually quite many things that we as defenders have an upper hand for. We can definitely notice many of these things. It's not like in the movies that things just happen. There are these six phases, some in some cases even more. And effectively, at least in the beginning, the attacker knows very, very little about our target environment. Unlike us as defenders, we have pretty good visibility, or at least we should have pretty good visibility. Definitely, it's at least it's doable. So these are the things: detection and ability to respond. I'm not saying that it's not important to stop exploitation. Definitely it is. But we've been trying to do that as an industry for now roughly 20, 30 years. And in the end, it is a losing battle. You have to somehow concentrate more on these layers. Any questions?
A second, is the microphone is now working. Yes, we could have a few questions now, and then we'll go to the presentations.
Raul Etelmäki from Danske Bank. How long does it take you to solve the puzzle? So to actually find the attacker and understand it comes from a satellite and all that.
If you're dealing with satellites, it takes a bit longer. But this was just one example. But roughly, the cases without satellites, roughly 1 week. Of course, it depends how big the target environment is, but few cases now, it's been 1 to 2 weeks.
Artem, what comes to motivation of these attackers, how it's roughly split between this kind of like business intel collection, what they're doing, and this kind of like direct financial impact, or basically collecting bank account information and stuff like that?
No, that's a very, very good question. The term that we use for that is attribution, like who did it, who benefited from it. I would say that the motivations very, very, very much. If you're making 5 million euros a day a profit, then most often the motivation is money. However, if you're dealing with confidential information, then usually it's that. So it really depends in what industry the target is in. But we've seen many kind of cases, some of them being absolutely competitive intelligence or business intelligence type of activity, as well as leaking confidential information out. So we've seen both.
And what comes to sources of attackers? Is it like if you roughly split it, between like different countries, is it a lot of Russia and China? Or?
First of all, I'd say that quite often countries don't attack anybody. There are groups of people that do those attacks. And like I said, you even now you can already buy these toolkits called Crime as a Service. So the investment of attacking your competitor, for example, is actually relatively low. So you don't have to pay like millions of euros in order to get these kind of toolkits. It's more like thousands of euros that you have to invest for it. So most definitely there are nation state actors in this game as well, because it's good investment. I mean, if you buy one Hellfire missile, that's roughly, I don't know, $500,000 or something. You fire it once and it's gone. If you buy these kind of toolkits, you can reuse them for ages before somebody like us finds your tools and burns them. But it's a really, really difficult thing to say who actually is using these. We have seen cases that are definitely targeting, like the ones targeting gaming industry and online gaming. It's obvious that those guys don't have any confidential secrets or nation state level information. It simply doesn't make any sense. And I don't think that their competitors are doing it either. So in that case, the motivation is simply money.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, still time for a couple. I could ask, there you go.
Yeah, Raul again. These defenders, are these usually companies with advanced sort of IT systems, defenses in place, or are they just companies that are waking up that there's actually a threat somewhere?
The diversity is huge. I mean, there are governmental entities that they are, like I said, gaming companies and whatnot. Also, the level of maturity is, the difference is just huge. Some of these targets, they have had all their systems in the cloud, as opposed to the ones that have everything administered by themselves. So the diversity is huge. In general, I would say that the victims have not been prepared for anything like this. That they are not prepared against these kind of attacks. They are using something that we call a coconut defensive model. So once you hit the hard shell and you break through that, everything inside is just soft.
Does cloud make this easier, or?
It just makes it different. One thing you have to understand, when most of your resources are in the cloud, you don't have control over the resources. So finding out simple things like whether your organization is actually sharing something that they shouldn't be sharing, that can be close to impossible to find out. Let's say that you're using services like Dropbox or similar services. How do you find out who in your organization has shared what? Typically, the answer is that you don't. You don't find it out. And the attackers know this, and they are using that to their advantage. Also, the same thing, if you have your emails in the Google appliance thing or whatever, the attackers know how to, they use those kind of things into their advantage. So they might add email filters that are just forwarding all incoming email to the attacker. You, as a user, you rarely go to your filters. That kind of filter can exist there for ages, and they have totally compromised all your emails without you knowing it. And had this been within your own organization, most definitely, at least, it had been much more difficult. So it's just different. Some things are easier when all your stuff is in the cloud. Some stuff is easier when you're hosting everything yourself. So
Okay, before we give the floor to Jens, I'll steal one more question. I know you can't directly discuss any customer cases, but could you somehow describe what has been the most complex case that you've been participating in solving, and what made it so complex to solve?
If you're dealing with huge environments, like thousands and thousands of workstations, and the attackers have been there for years, then suddenly that is a kind of case that you don't solve in 1 week. It takes months and months. So those kind of cases can be really, really challenging, because if the attackers have taken over the network for, let's say, 5 years ago or something, there are no employees in those organizations any longer who even remember how the network was laid out back in 5 years ago. And the attackers have had all the time in the world to take over everything that they want. In those cases, those are really, really challenging, because you can't trust anything. So you have to, the first thing in our case is to try to build on some foundation, make some assumptions, and then tripwire the environment so that if something bad happens, we actually have even a remote chance of noticing it.
Okay, thank you, Tommy. And then we give the floor to Jens, and he'll hopefully explain us on how companies are defending and how we are helping them. So
yeah,
go ahead.
Thank you. Yes, pwned. Does anybody in here know what that means? Yeah, there's a lot in the behind, but yeah, actually, can you tell me? Yeah. Yeah. It's hacker slang, and it actually means that the hacker has taken control over your computer. It's just what Tommy has been giving you an example of. So, yeah, a little bit to set the scene. This is our daily work. We work with this and try to solve the problem of many companies being pwned. My name is Jens Tonke. I'm the head of cybersecurity services and one of the founders of this recently acquired company, Ensens. So the agenda, I will try to give you a little bit of market overview and key trends in the market, our offerings and channels, a little bit about our competitions, even though that we have now entered a new league, enabling growth, what is our view on that, and key initiatives and must-win battles. But before that, I will try to set the scene with a little bit of a story about Home Depot. I guess you all know that company. It's not the most sexy hack, and I will not go into details about how they were hacked and so on, but they were hacked in September 2014, and I could have used many examples, but this is actually quite interesting also, because there has been done some aftermath on some analytics to see how did this attack actually affected Home Depot. So anybody remember anything from the story? They were a breach. And actually, some hackers stole 56 million credit card information. So wow, that's bad, right? But how bad is it? What consequences does that have? 56 million credit card information, what does that mean? Okay, you can think a little bit about that. Then this was easily, you know, they were not breached for a long time. 5 months, they found out they had been breached for 5 months. So these guys has been stealing information from them in 5 months. So, and guess how they discovered this? How did they find out that they were breached? Any ideas? Anybody read the story? No. They found out because the credit card information was on sale on the internet. So these guys, the bad guys, was actually selling these huge amounts of credit card information on the internet. And actually, they try to buy back this credit information, so to kind of stop the damage. So that was one thing. So then of course there is, you know, when something like this happens, and you said, okay, it takes maybe a week to solve the case. I would say a case like this, I think they still are you know, working on the damages from that case, and I think it was Forbes that came out with an estimate of the cost of this breach in March 2015. So what kind of cost would you think that will be in connection with such a breach? What cost will there be if you're breached by a hacker in your company? So what kind of cost would you expect to have? Yeah, but not also in terms of what kind of actions do you need to do? Yeah, that costs money. So there will be more cost for investigations. That means Tommy, remediation. Okay, we need to have new security measures in place. There will be identity theft repair. There will be regulatory fines. It is PCI. Have you heard about the PCI payment card industry? It's a what do you call that? All the big credit cards has founded this together in order to do a minimum security level for all companies handling credit card information. So they want to enforce this by having regulations in place, and everybody that handles credit card information actually has to comply to this regulation. And that's actually a huge business for us. It's something that we have been doing for many years, and it's one of the major drivers in the market. And we have many of these regulations actually. But if they are breached, and even though that they have been compliant to PCI, if they are breached, there will be a fine for each credit card information that you lose of approximately $50. And then you can do the math yourself. It's like 56 million times $50. But it doesn't stop with that. Then you have disruption in normal business. You have a lost business. You have lawsuits. And they already had, I think, more than 50 lawsuits because of this incident. And then you have, just to give a very simple example, they have a notification to individuals. 56 million individuals. Just sending out a letter to them and paying for the stamp is $27 million. So it's quite a lot of money we are talking about. And actually, according to Forbes and their estimate, they say that it will cost Home Depot all in all more than $10 billion, this breach. So that I think is interesting. So as mentioned earlier, regulations is for sure something that drives the market, has been driving the market for many years now. We entered the PCI business, I think, more than 5 years ago. Many of the products that we have developed is compliant to PCI, so we can use it in connection with the business that is driven by the PCI. We have also World Lottery Association. It's one of our big verticals also that we work with. And we have the EU data protection reform, which has a lot of focus on privacy, which is our turf nowadays. Have you anybody heard about the fines that they are talking about here? If you don't comply, if you have a breach and they actually find out that you have had personal sensitive information that you have not encrypted and these information are stolen from your company, they are talking fines in the level of 100 of million euro. So it's the law is not in place yet, but they expect it to be next year. And already now we have several of our customers that are actually working on being able to be compliant and fulfill this new law. Attacks increases. This is something that we have experienced ourselves during the last year. As Tomi also mentioned, we have done more than 100 plus incident response jobs, and they have been increasing. Actually, we have been educating all our consultants in how to handle incident response, what to do and what not to do, which is also extremely important. They are getting increasingly more advanced and requires greater skill sets, that's for sure. And what we also see now here is also a big demand for actually being prepared on when. It's not a matter of if you're getting hacked, it's more a matter of when you are getting hacked. And are you able to detect that? And do you have all the processes and procedures in place to be able to handle such an attack in a proper way to reduce the cost connected with that? So also based on what I just told, the story about the home page, there's a lot of these stories out there. So this was just one example, but definitely this gets, you know, the C-level's focus, because now it's just not, you know, about security. Actually, we had I cannot mention the name, but it was not really a company, but somebody they worked for, and on the C-level, when they were hacked, they actually said, "Wow, that is really truly exciting. You know, what happened? Wow, we got hacked. You know, oh, finally I can tell something, you know, exciting to my wife when I come home." But they didn't really, you know, think about the consequences that it can have. But now with these new cases that has been exposed in the media recently, it is definitely on the C-level's table and the board level, because this can actually put you out of business. 10 billions in, you know, in cost, it, you know, you risk to lose your entire business. So, whoops. Yeah, what does this mean for us, and what do we see that it actually means that we are getting increasing budgets for this? Companies want to do this properly. They don't just want to fix it with a new firewall, a perimeter solution or something like that. They know that it takes more than that. It takes awareness campaigns. It takes a lot of processes and procedures that needs to be in place in order to be prepared for this. What we also do is we do more target-driven tests, and what that is, I will come back to that. And very important is also that when an attack happens, and that is actually also something that we like attacks, but what it does to our business is that it kind of reduces the amount of time that we use on making, you know, an offer and negotiate and so on, because they call us, we have an attack, please come and help us. Yeah, what about budgets? If the budgets, you just come now and you just do what it takes to get us out of this trouble. Attacks increasing, this is not only something that we experience, this is also something that PricewaterhouseCoopers has recently done a research about. It's increasing dramatically. And as they also say here, it's not only an issue that concerns the information technology and security professional, the impact extends to the C-suite and boardroom. And please be aware that many attacks are not reported at all. So I guess there is even more than this. This is some figures on the detect and response market. What we expect to see in the future is that the market is moving a little bit not a way, but you need to at least to extend it with some detect and respond services. And this is, of course, an area where we put a lot of effort into at the moment. We have been in this area for a long time, and the detect area is something that we are about to launch some very exciting new products about. And you can say expected growth, it's not a lot, but I tell you, even 5% of this market will mean that we will grow, you know, two-digit figure and even more over the next couple of years. So the main target markets for us is managed security services, proactively managed security services, automated detection and alerting, and incident response. This is something that we have been working with for many years now, but managed services proactively being able to detect and automatically detect and send an alert to a trusted partner that actually are able to react on when do you have an incident. This is, if not the silver bullet, something, you know, that comes really close to that. Drivers in the market besides regulations and so on, and why we think that this is a good place to be, is there's a lack of cybersecurity professionals. The demand is definitely a lot bigger than what we are able to supply them with. And we need to come up with some smarter solution where we combine, as Christian also mentioned, we need to combine product and people in order to be able to solve this huge demand. Cybersecurity is a process. This is not our invention. This is actually something we from Gartner. But it's actually the way we have been working for many years now. So what we try to do whenever we meet a new customer is to take a more holistic approach to the customer. We need to understand what is, or the company needs to understand, what is the real risk here in the company? What is the most valuable asset you have in the company? So, and how can these critical assets, how can they be attacked? You know, what is the attack vector, so to say? And you need to uncover the weak spot. So we have security management people, risk management people to help you find out where is it that you should use your time and effort and resources, what is the important part of the business. Prevent, it's not a business that we have been so much into, but it's a business that F-Secure has been into for many, many years. Detect, recognize incidents, isolate and contain them, and respond, react to breaches, mitigate the damage, and analyze and learn. Our cybersecurity offerings, and actually I think there will be more slides in details. I don't know how much in detail I want to go into this, but actually we are able to offer all the needed services that will be to help out enterprise businesses. So we have risk management and security management. We have security advisor. This actually means that we are on a more strategic level, help out people or companies how to solve the problems in the future and on what technology should they choose, how should they build security and so on. And we also have products on our shelf that will go more into threat intelligence, not helping the companies to find out not about, you know, the weak spots and so on, but where would the most potential attack come from? Because it's, you know, the internet is huge and the possibilities are even bigger, right? So we need to try to reduce the scope a little bit and see, okay, who are the guys that will most likely hack us and how will they do it? And that, therefore, we need threat intelligence. So prevent, compliance and security improvements, vulnerability management, here we actually have a product that can help companies doing self-assessment using a scanner we have developed to do all the basic what is needed to see how is your security level at the moment. Training and security culture, we have educated more than I think 200 developers around the globe in how to write secure code to actually stop reduce the vulnerabilities where they actually start. What is the root cause for this? Eliminate them. Anti-malware, email and web traffic scanning. The new thing that we are going to launch in 2016. We are already now running beta internally and out at customers. And for sure, this is going to be a really growing area. And then the response, forensic incident response, and so on. As I say here, we will combine the capabilities of, this is us, and the labs. And that's actually, I don't think we have mentioned that too much, but having the access to the labs is actually something that helps us tremendously in solving many of these cases. We can do it a lot faster and better than we could before that. This is more in detail about the different kind of services that we're offering. I think I'm a little bit on time, so I will skip some of these. We have many. One that I would like to pick out is, let's see if I can find it. I cannot find it here. But what we actually are doing more and more is we're doing projects called where we actually simulate a real attack. The company asks us to say, okay, we would very much like to see how vulnerable are we actually. So you are we define three targets: get access to the CEO's mailbox, get an admin account on our ERP system, and get Sysmin take over or something like that. We can use all means actually to achieve these attacks or to achieve these targets. So we can actually break in. We can physically break in. Sometimes we are allowed to do that to see, okay, what happens. We do tailgating in buildings. We place small devices to tap their network internally. We do social engineering. We are sending them malware, as Tomi has just told you about. And everything is with the CEO's blessing. And what we find out is, as Tomi also mentioned, that very often company security is like a coconut, you know, hard shell, but inside it's completely soft. And it takes us minutes to compromise them really badly. So therefore, in the future, the need of being able to detect when you are attacked will be super critical, and the ability to respond correctly on this will also be extremely important. Our competitive edge, I very much think that because we have a holistic approach to our customers, and we have all the underneath tools and skill set by our consultants, that we have the ability to win. We have been taking, you know, some really nice customers in recently, and we are competing with many of the bigger guys here. This is a little bit about how our revenue split is by product and verticals. As you can see, most of this represent guys like Tomi, our technical security services. We have security management services which are more into compliancy processes and procedures. And then we have products. Products are not a very big part of our revenue at the moment, but that's something we aim to grow together with F-Secure. We have had a very vertical oriented strategy, meaning that we have been mainly selling to the financial sector. As you can see, that financial sector actually represents more than 35% of our revenue. And you can actually many times say that this, the 30% plus the 35, is actually representing the financial sector, because many of the service providers that we have as a customer is big data centers delivering services to the financial sector. Gaming, gambling companies, world-leading brands, and others. We try to do a little bit of statistic. We don't want to disclose which customer we are working for, but we found out that actually 55% of the top Nordic companies is customer that we work for. So coming back to what is the most important thing for us now and in the future, it is to create the best solution for incident detection and response, where we again combine product and services, and of course maintain and recruit the best of the best cybersecurity professionals. And in that perspective, focus on developing and retaining the people is something that we have been working on for many years, and something that we will continue to work on as well, and have been quite successful in actually. Yeah, I think that was it.
Okay. Is the mic on? Yes. Thank you, Jens. And now we have Pekka next. So Pekka, please go on.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Glad to be here with you. I think that's what Christian said pretty much the first time. I would say also maybe in my history, I joined the company 1995, so it was like maybe we were around 25, 29 people at that time. So I've been here for a while and basically doing nothing else but the security, of course, pretty different roles in whole through the company history. I mean, from 25 employee to what, 950 or so today. Running the corporate security business line, so which is kind of now in between the consumer and the cyber services business unit led by Jens. So mostly we are still focused about the SMBs. Of course, the drive here as well is to get to larger companies, get to larger deal size. But let's start from what's also very visible in our web at the moment. Don't be an easy target. That's basically the thinking. 4 out of 5 incidents, or let's say the attacks, the modern attacks are today because of, or the data breaches are because of people running unupdated software in their systems. And not meaning operating system, but really the applications that you use on top of it. And of course, those unupdated application software, Skype, Adobe, whatever you use, have vulnerabilities, will be exploited, as explained by Tommy. And that is, of course, then the true case of today. And why is it so? Why is it interesting? 75% of those attacks are really money-driven. So it's all about money. And where's that coming from? Of course, it's from the pure fact that the information the assets companies have is worth of money. And that's what the attackers, the criminals, of course, are after. And I would bet there's no big difference between the enterprise and SMB in that context. SMBs might be just in a bit of a, I would say, more difficult place from the point of view that, okay, consumers might not have an interest when it comes to the attackers. There's no money necessarily in that. Enterprises do have a bigger risk, bigger money to lose, assets to lose, but also they have much, I would say, fat wallet to protect against. So SMBs are there somewhere in between. Clear monetary value, not necessarily the skills, competencies to protect against. And I think this is a clear problem F-Secure is answering to by providing services and solutions against of this track. And still, by the way, today, I would say the first line of defense against the modern malware is still to have an adequate endpoint protection in place. That's the starting point. Agenda pretty much already same that what Jens had about on the right side, the picture, why is it there? I think we see not only in the enterprise game, but all through the IT. IT is getting more dispersed, you know, a lot of different devices coming in, different type of services, cloud, on-premise, whatnot. IT security altogether is getting even more complex. And I think by being able to simplify the security and the related management, it is truly an asset and a competitive advantage. It is not just a nice GUI, but really to be able to play well on the high user experience provided for the end customers through the partners. That's what I fully believe in. Some of the key market drivers: mobility, truly I believe one of the biggest transformation in the market. IDC, I think, already a few years back predicted that, you know, 1.6 times the PCs there will be post-PC devices. And I think we're all living that life by having those smart tablets, phones next to our laptops and PCs. Bring your own device, bring your own application, even bring your own service. Definitely a great promise of productivity, efficiency boost. Yet it comes a bit of a flip side of the coin that security considerations are in quite many cases outsourced to the poor end user, which is bad. And I think the use cases when it comes to the security should be considered to be equal for the PC and post-PC era devices, because practically what you use it for is to access the confidential data information pretty much the same way from the tablet to PC to your smartphone. It's just a different type of a computer you are playing with. And that leads us to the conclusion that we want to play the best endpoint security game across all the devices, regardless PC or post-PC. For me, it is yet another computer to be protected well against, now and in the future. Cloudification, one of the big drivers again. From the business's point of view, provides a big promise of the efficiency, production cost, TCO, and so forth, getting so much more in a affordable level. But I think it also, from the security standpoint, makes it, as what Tommy said, different, but I dare to say also it makes it more complex. And this is a fair, I would say, IT, but IT security usability problem that it comes with. And I think F-Secure is here to play a fair game in winning some of the markets in that space. Advanced threats, regardless of the size of the company or even the industry or vertical, it doesn't make any difference. SMBs do not live in isolation. They are quite often, you know, a value chain supplier for bigger customers or the bigger enterprises. So this is truly an area of interest, truly an interest for us to really solve it the best possible way. And in my books, when SMB game is pretty much served towards the channel or via channel to make it in a fashion that we can provide enterprise scale advanced threat protection affordable for the small and medium enterprises. So these are the drivers, the true the key beliefs I built the story, but also the solution and services around. The main markets, the areas we play today, simply the endpoint protection, that's the multi-billion market. In my books, it also includes the mobile devices. As I said, for me, it is just yet another type of a endpoint, and that those endpoints better be protected and secured from the beginning. Centralized management, I don't basically, I can't disconnect the endpoint protection from the centralized management. It's basically for businesses, the management is the key to be able to play an efficient security and protection preparedness scheme. And that is definitely, I would say, equally important than when it comes to the true endpoint protection is that how do you manage, how do you get control over it? And then, of course, network security. Pretty much today, how we have it is that we are talking about the web and email filtering there. We are not going for, you know, I would say, for the traditional network layer protection. And why I don't believe it is relevant in that context is, okay, because of the mobility, the device is more and more outside the company premises, somewhere there on the move. But still, I believe that companies will be emailing for quite many years to come. Even though it sounds a bit, how to say, boring, old-fashioned, but that's the way life is. Companies are truly traditional in many ways. And you can see it even in the area of the PC shipments. Yes, true, declining globally, but still you see companies are using those. Seem to be very convenient solution, Mac PCs. They just work. And of course, when invested now, they will stay there in the companies for years to come. About the endpoint protection, we were talking about the detect and response market. I believe that will be further on in the time, be kind of a swallowed or merged into the I would say today known endpoint protection market also as such, because this is pretty much what happened with the firewalls, with the spam or anti-spam, parental control, anything like that. It's just the continuum of the game. Still about the management, one word or line. PC and a post-PC devices combined, it is truly a big management problem. And I would say even before the management, there's a bit of what's the visibility for your fleet in your company? Say you have hundreds of employees. What are the devices those people use? What of those are personally owned? What are the company owned? Nevertheless, how are those protected, if at all? Do you know? And I think there's a big problem to be solved in that, and in a clever and intuitive and a simplified way. That's why I believe the centrally managed security is a core way of playing the game. That was already opened by Jens, but if this is interesting, if you take a look at, I mean, six months ago, the portfolio would have looked completely different. And now that we got the Ensense, truly, I would say, talented people in, this looks quite, I would say, interesting and compelling. Of course, my story here starts pretty much from the right-hand corner, and is quite, I would say, product-centric in that respect. But we don't have to wait for too long when we get the advanced threat protection solution launched first, pretty much direct to enterprises. But of course, fast, we better see it also available in a scalable fashion to be sold through the channel towards the small and medium enterprises. And of course, mostly in the fashion of security as a service. There you see, this is now about the portfolio. What do we have in the setup as of today? And on the green background, that you pretty much see that, okay, the endpoint protection is the core. And I would say, regardless whether we are talking about server, desktop, laptop, be it a smartphone, iOS, Android, we cover it all, and all links back to the central management, meaning anything and everything here will be truly integrated under one user experience for the efficiency from the partner point of view who provides the security as a service, or the IT admin back in the company IT security department. And then, of course, freedom for business we introduced earlier this year is really opening us a, I would say, truly new also the mobile security game in that respect. And you know, management is really putting the IT or the IT admin, be it partner, in a sole control of the setup and security. Two flavors we have today. Kind of a two solution lines we offer to the market. On the on the blue side, we have a genuine cloud service hosted by F-Secure, provided as a service to small and medium enterprises. And now the partners, of course, are the value-added resellers, managed service partners, plus 4,000 as we have it globally. Pretty much the same level of great security, but more for the on-premise also for the bigger customers who have the IT competencies, skills, capabilities in place, and they want to do it or they have to do it on-premise. Further on, you will see it happening that actually we start merging these two solution lines, so that regardless of the fact whether the company or the customer wants to have it on-premise or take it from the cloud, it will be one solution line for the efficiency, for the ease of training, for the ease of acquisition, and so forth. Competitive edge. So you see pretty much the usual suspects when it comes to the competition. Of course, some variants there might be from market to market, but these are the ones we basically play against. And as said, Business Suite, Protection Service for Business, share quite much of the competitive, I would say, edges. The knockout points are the same. Maybe one thing here is that, okay, tough to see, but anyway, the true feedback from the customers based on the customer satisfaction survey. But how do we win is basically, how do we differentiate from the other vendors? One big thing is the accuracy of protection. Accuracy in the end of the day turns or equals to the TCO of the solution. Be it very accurate day in, day out, 24/7, every second, every minute, means that okay, the customer or the partner will have less incidents, and it will be truly a cost advantage in this respect. And also ease of use and functionality. One can say how unique is that, not necessarily at all, but this is pretty much what we get from the field, that we are able to play the game with very, I would say, core functionality as such. This looks pretty cool. This is something we are now about to get out during this year, and it's really fundamentally changing the I would say, the perception of IT security. Thought to be really complex, we want to make it the other way around. We want to make it very simple, very intuitive. And it is not just, I mean, putting lipstick on the bulldog, but really change and be able to, how to say, improve and make enhanced the processes, especially the partners provide the security with. So really simplifying their daily routines and make it more affordable as a business model also for them. And the high user experience is one of the key advantages when it comes to competitiveness in long run, I believe. The other ones, of course, to innovate on the technology and the business model side. And the business model is a key point here because we sell through the channel. And for the channel, we have to be able to provide, I would say, more money with less effort than the competition. If you're able to do that, then they will stay with us. First half 2015, Net Promoter Score. All you know, most likely the theory, that okay, the higher the ratio, of course, in long run, it should be pretty much equal to the company's financial performance, be it profit, but also the growth. And glad to see that 8 out of 10 partners are either very or loyal with us, which means that okay, they find our solution services very relevant, easy to sell, easy to support, and of course when compared to competition. This is good news, absolutely.
some performance figures or takeaways. I fully believe security as a service, as a part of, I would say, the way people and especially the companies are consuming IT, but consuming IT security, it's just there and in the growth. And we are, especially with the protection service for business, our cloud solution, we seem to be pretty much on the pace with the market. And I believe this trend will be even steeper in the future. The way people, as said, companies will consume security as a part of IT, it is more and more on renting base. So security as a service provided by a trusted value-added reseller or managed service partner is the way to go. On the right-hand side, yes, we are very much Europe and even Nordic-centric, maybe with an exclusion of Japan, where we've been playing the game for roughly 20 years, and we seem to be doing awfully well there. Fastest growing countries, pretty much today, France, Benelux, and Japan. Some key initiatives. Sales execution efficiency, really the focus is in the new customer, the new partner, meaning net new hunt. That's where the growth comes. The so-called renewal business we have outsourced for efficiency reasons. And this is, by the way, a very important part of the game, because so big part of our business is on the renewals. And by dealing well with the renewals, of course, we can then increase the customer lifetime value. And it makes that we can also then put more emphasis and even efforts in the new customer hunt by the fact that the customers will stay with us. Run rate business, meaning the smaller dealer business, fully through the channel, whereas then F-Secure has or is on the driver's seat when it comes to the bigger deals. But quite often in this case as well, the channel will be the one who finally make the case. We just help them to excel in that. As brought by Christian, SMB boosts in France and DACH since 2014, very positive signals. And we believe now that we have kind of the growth formula forming up, and we are able to invest on top of that. Channel, as said, the go-to-market model is very simple. Quality and quantity, you need both. Plus 4,000 today, globally. We have to get more of those, but also more, I would say, high-profile partners to ramp up the deal size, ramp up the value-added reseller, the reseller value. And of course, in that respect, with all the fairness, channel is kind of a lazy animal in that respect. That of course, they want us to do as much work for them as possible. And that's fair, that's the name of the game. So you have to be feeding and really, really, really giving them the leads and in as automated fashion as possible. And I think we are pretty good in that. Solution competitiveness, as said, I fully believe the user experience is one of the key competitive advantages for us, and we will be building on it. Then also, why a service design approach to be really able to nail down, on partners' daily business processes, some of the areas where we really can excel and make it so much easier for partner to sell and play with us than the competition. So again, like more money with less effort in that respect. And then, as said already, the yellow-blue chart, so start unifying the two solutions into one excellent, where then the customer makes the decision whether I want to take it from the cloud or whether I want to have it on my premise. And finally, must wins. SaaS game, as said, my full belief, this is the future way of playing the business when it comes to security. Why? Because security gets more complex. It is less and less a core for the companies, and thus they outsource that part together with the IT outsourcing to their trusted partner in local markets, which leads to the channel game. To be really able to play it efficiently, we also have to seek different type of business models, and I would say ability to serve the partner, the channel, in that respect better. And this will be a truly a, we have a good traction on that with PSP, but I think there's plenty of room to be done still in that area. And then, last but not least, how do we get the security services, business lines, great talents, great services, productized into such a fashion that we can start selling them through the channel globally. Not necessarily with the current channel one-to-one, but I think out of those 4,000 plus, we have some who can already now manage this type of services. And of course, those type of partners we have to be seeking for more. That's the way to build then the scale in the effect. All right. I think that was break for the questions.
Yes, not yet time for the actual break, but now we have some time for questions and answers regarding the corporate business. I'll invite Jens and Tommy as well here, so you can also ask about cyber attacks if you want to. We have some 10 plus minutes, so we can use all of that.
Raul Etelmäki, Danske Bank again. Two questions on the cybersecurity. Given your current resources, are you able to keep up with the market growth? I believe there were 69 employees that was acquired from Ensense. And then the second question is, could you describe your revenue model a bit? I mean, you had a lot of products. Are these like a three-year fixed contract, or how does it work?
Yeah, no to the first. We cannot keep up with the demand in the market. That is a big challenge. Our revenue model consists of course ad hoc projects. I would say most of our business, when we look into a new fiscal year, we know that 80% of our revenue will come where it will come from. Because most company has like a wheel, year wheel on what kind of test they want to do and so on. And there's a lot of compliancy and regulation stuff that actually dictates that you need to have four yearly quarterly scans, you need to have one penetration test and so on. So, and some of these we have actually many year contract on, or you so and we see actually, I don't think we have lost, of course, we maybe have lost some customers, but mainly when we lose a customer, it's because the people that we knew and did business with, they changed company and then we got a new customer. So that's how it has been. Yeah.
Sami Sarkamme, Nordea Markets. I could continue on cybersecurity. It seems that Ensense is the clear market leader in the Nordic countries. You talk about the European market as a whole,
yeah,
as the target market for these services going forward. What is the go-to-market plan? So how will you become a player in the larger European countries? What does it take? And what's roughly the timeline?
The timeline is, and then I have need to back up from Christian here, but it's 3 to 5 years. And we will use the business model that we have been using so far, which has been very successful. So we will be very true to the skill set of the companies we will acquire, or the people that we want to take in terms of organic growth.
Kimmo Stevan, Pohjola. A little bit of personal question. What was the main motivation to sell the business to F-Secure?
There were several, actually. There was also several potential buyers, and there has been that during the years. But we found that F-Secure actually was the right buyer because the core value of the company was very similar to ours. So we didn't anticipated any cultural mismatch there. And also, you can say the goals and the vision that F-Secure had has in within this area were very similar to ours. And that combined with the huge resources in their labs, which we saw a big benefit on the global reach, and the resources that we didn't have ourselves actually was the main factors in that. And also, I will say that it's a European player. Being bought by an American company would also be an option, but we found that, you know, our culture and what we want to do in the longer run was much more in harmony with F-Secure stands for.
Onni Hautala, Maalattom Life. A question regarding this security as a service game that you need to win. Now you're coming out with a product in this detection segment, and this seems like the place to go, since it should provide the scalability in the corporate security business.
Correct.
Are there existing products in this space by your competitors, and what kind of challenges have there been that have prevented you from going into this space earlier?
We have been in the incident response for a long time, but the detection, actually the idea behind the product came up because our customers was quite frustrated that whenever we did a targeted attack simulation, we kind of pwned them every time. So we more or less had 100% success rate in actually taking over and breaking into to these companies. So and they say, okay, what can we do about this? And I said, yeah, you need to optimize your some of the procedures you have and processes, and you need some perimeter security, and you need, you know, to do more often tests and so on. But to be honest, we also knew that next year when we would do the same test, we will definitely pwn them again. So actually, I talked to, I think Tomi came up with the idea, to be honest, but I said, okay, can we not come up with something that would be able to detect the attacks that we are doing? So instead of try to prevent all the time, actually be able to detect when is it that an attack is happening, so we can respond quickly and correctly on that.
If I may add to that, yeah. So the idea is actually pretty old. Back in the days when casinos were a big thing, when Las Vegas was kind of built on, or this whole gambling industry was booming, the casinos learned pretty quickly that they are not able to stop all the hustlers and all the con men taking advantage of casinos. Then, and that became known as the casino theory. So they hired some ex-con men and some ex-hustlers, ex-gamblers, and built a catwalk above the gaming area. So, because it takes one to know one. And these guys were walking down the catwalk and spotting all the guys that were suspicious. I spent 4 years of my life dealing with electronic voting. And at that time, I did some heavy research on gambling industry, because voting and gambling are actually pretty close to each other. Nobody likes any of the players, nobody trusts any of the players, and still the system has to work somehow. And that's where we took those lessons from. We're doing lots of this kind of like lateral studying of things, looking at safe cracking, looking at lock picking, looking at casino industry, gambling, and all those ideas, and then just applying them to the information security world. That's basically how we operate. And one more comment regarding the recruitment. It's like hunting bears. You don't have to be faster than the bear, you just need to be faster than your friends. So that's our methodology when it comes to recruitment as well.
Alex Oinen, Danske Bank. This question might be a bit stupid, but I don't care. Internally speaking, what about insurance companies? How they are reacting to these cyber threats internal at the moment, and how they will comply to these threats going forward? So basically, briefly, can I just buy a product in order to hedge these risks?
I can answer that.
Yeah.
So currently there are a few big players in the industry or the insurance company business that are offering cyber kind of like cyber insurances or whatever you would call them, we're watching closely that. And in the Nordics at the moment, all the players that offer any kind of cyber insurances are global, huge global companies. There are no local players that actually offer it. And most probably that will mean more business for us, because they actually need somebody to find out whether they can sell the insurance. And especially if something goes horribly wrong, they need somebody to figure out how to minimize their damage. I mean, now I'm talking about the insurance company, damage to the insurance company, because this might come as a huge surprise to most of you, but insurance companies, they don't really generally like paying out money.
Maybe what comes to Ensense still, how far are you planning to go what comes to integration of the company into AppSec? For example, looking at R&D assets and common products, and you already mentioned usage of lab facilities and capabilities there.
Yeah, as much as it makes sense to do it. That's so our plan.
May I?
Yeah, of course.
So we have already now seen that we already prior to the acquisition, we had a pretty strong capabilities doing incident response. One area where we were lacking totally was threat intelligence. And we have already now seen that it's like, you know, if you're running a SWAT team, it's really, really tedious to go inside in total darkness. But with the threat intelligence, we actually, the room is already kind of illuminated when we're getting in. Because the threat intel guys, they are like masters of building kind of recon information based on the tidbits of information that we get in the beginning. And the threat intelligence guys in the labs, they have been a huge value for us. And also because we get the value, then we are putting it to the reports and also informing the customers. So previously, for example, we could tell the customer that, okay, this was the kind of attack that was done against you. But now we can also add that this is a known campaign that has been running for 2 years, and it's been operated by these kind of operators, and they're been targeting energy sector and transportation and whatnot. We can offer the background story to the incident, and also add value through that. It's not only that. It's the threat intelligence is part of it, but there is also strong capabilities in the malware protection area. They are really good at reverse engineering, and they have huge backend systems here at the labs that we didn't have previously. So it's kind of match made in heaven. We are yin and yang. We are kind of everybody is bringing the good parts on the table, yeah, so to say.
And truly, the ATP initiative, actually, exactly. Jens is just about to launch, is one of the, I would say, one of the concrete example of the integration in action. So basically, that's a pretty much a joint effort, and actually multi-team, multi-site effort, yeah, actually, to put it together with us on the corporate side of the game.
One thing also that people rarely consider is that if you look at the industry players in general, all the acquisition, if you look at the FireEyes or the Mandiants of the game, Mandiant used to be a forensics shop built by ex-cops. Those guys are specializing on forensics, which is kind of nice, but we are professional hackers. We are breaking into things and places. If you want to break into a building, which one you ask, cop or a robber? That's the kind of there is a huge difference in the mindset and also in the skill set, and I personally strongly believe that that's going to make us stronger than any other competitor, because we are professional attackers. Like I said, it takes one to know one, and that way we can combine those two things and make a perfect match out of it.
And maybe second question regarding to what comes to this Home Depot example you mentioned.
Yeah.
I guess the lesson is that cyber attacks are pretty expensive exercise for companies and so on. So are there many companies who are actually conscious that they are presumably hacked, but are not really eager to do anything because they are likely to get some fines and this costly process and the CTO is likely to get fired and so on?
I would say that the last couple of years, people, because of all the attacks that has been brought up in the media, people are now aware that we need to do something, but they are also kind of a little bit, desperate, okay, what is it that we need to do? And that's why I think that the detection area will explode more or less. And for us, it will not be a question of if we have not enough projects or enough customers. It will be a question of which customers will be the most strategically important for us and lucrative to work with in the longer run.
Okay, thank you for the questions. Thank you for the presenters.
That was one more question down there. I don't
know. No, yeah, there's one more time and then we need to go for the break.
Heikki Kinnunen from Ilmarinen. I get the impression from your speeches that that the demand is extremely strong and so forth. But looking at the estimate for the market growth, it's about 6%.
Mm.
So what am I missing?
Yeah. Yes, thank you.
Yeah, I suppose we have a lot to do in a new product that needs to come out next year. And also, basically we have to have the solution as well. And then also recruitment. And by the way, on the comments on recruitments, and this is not a change in the guidance in any way, and next year guidance we haven't given, as we never do until we get into February. So I think the recruitment issue is something that we're doing short term, mid-term, long-term plans on how to do right, and I think that it is a key hindrance for us. Clearly, it's very clearly a key hindrance, as Jens said, and we need very skilled people to be able to do that kind of growth as well for us that we aim in this space. So that's something where the employment and how do we find the talent is a very crucial part of what we need to do from now onwards, and where we believe, of course, that this hardcore brand that we have carries weight as well. But we need to prove that in terms of how are we able to recruit better in a combined entity versus what Jens and the team has been able to grow earlier on their own. And I had one more comment because I know that Tommy meant that, but of course we have white hackers, right? So we are ethical hackers in terms of all our actions, right? But I know Tommy meant that, and that's the way the guys are. It's so self-evident for them, but good to remind everybody. And good questions on the guidance as well. Thank you.
Okay, so now we need to take a break. You can refill the coffee mugs, and we will get back to the session in about 11 minutes. So thank you, guys.
A lot of questions concerning the SMP side of the game. There was not a single one, so I'm quite disappointed.
So welcome back also for the audience online, and also to you all. Now we turn our focus to the consumer side of the company, which still represents a big share of our revenue and profits. So Samu, please, it's yours now.
Thanks, Tapio. So the next about half an hour we'll spend around the consumer security. So as was coming from an earlier slide from Christian, so this splits between two main go-to-market models. So first being the operator channel. We have more than 200 operator partners, and that alone represents a bit more than 50% of F-Secure revenues. And then the other part would be the F-Secure, what we call direct-to-consumer business, where we sell our products directly to consumer from F-Secure e-channels. And also, when you buy F-Secure products through other channels than operator channels, so in our books, we also call that direct to consumer. So although often there is a channel in play, so as an example, if you walk to Verkkokauppa here in Finland or similar companies in many parts of the Nordics, so you do find the F-Secure products. So that we also call direct to consumer business. So as the headline says, this is really the profit engine of the company, really the most profitable part of our operations, and we see a lot of very interesting growth opportunities here as well, and I'll walk them through this. The agenda is very similar as with my colleagues Pekka and Jens, so we talk about the market first in brief, and then looking at the growth opportunities and whatever we call our must-win battles and the key initiatives at the end. So if you look at the market drivers, so we are now splitting this according to our products first, and then we'll talk about the specific market. So first would be the F-Secure Safe that many of you would know as the internet security industry. So this really is where a big part of company short-term cash is at. This is practically about 50% of F-Secure revenues. The main drivers there is that the consumer threat landscape that continues charging forward, unfortunately for the consumers. The threats sometimes look very different versus what we heard from our cyber guys on the targeted and very, very advanced attacks that the big companies face. But consumers also are in for quite a bit of trouble for what comes to ransom Trojans. And so somebody goes and hijacks your PC, encrypts everything, and then you are held as a ransom. You pay through PayPal some money to somebody somewhere in Russia, China, wherever, and only after that your PC gets opened. Or whether it comes to these ever-evolving phishing attacks that the bad guys are after your identity, your credentials, so that they could get into your bank account and get all your money. And I believe a good example was just going around the web a couple of days here ago in Finland. So it's not just the electronic hustle anymore, but now there's been cases that somebody calls you, Christian, and says that, hello, this is Monica from Nordea. There are some problems with your bank, so could you please give us your banking credentials? And most of us is like, no. Is it really Nordea calling? Are you really asking me, like, what is my password number 13? So most people don't fall for it, but some do. And that's why those bad guys keep on trying and trying and pushing, because there's a lot of money to be made. So that is really what continues driving the consumer demand for this industry. It's a pretty big industry, about $6 billion. And as we saw in the beginning from Christian, so overall this consumer industry we see as a small growth, not as fast growth as it was, say, 5-7 years ago, but still we see it as a growth opportunity for F-Secure. Then for something new, so our product Freedom, which now addresses this privacy topic, so awareness for what comes to privacy on online people, so how much information is gathered from you, or whether you are being tracked and profiled. So the overall awareness for people is just increasing that, hey, this can't be all good, and we see a lot of demand, a growing demand, a fast growing demand, and people want solutions to somehow safeguard their privacy. It's a new market for us. If we had this session 3 years ago, we wouldn't be in this game at all, and I said that there wasn't much of that game existing even. So it is a new market, and we are also facing new competitors there, so this is not against the good old Symantec and McAfee's yet. I guess just time will tell whether those guys will enter this game and with how much muscle they will come in. But today this is predominantly new competitors, some old competitors as well. Some of our existing antivirus competitors are hedging into that market as well. And then the last here is this protecting their digital home. So what is it that F-Secure is going to be doing there? So unfortunately, we are not yet announcing our offering on that space today. But we've poured a lot of thoughts and a lot of research and a lot of engineering effort already in that on that space. So something is coming, but today we are not telling it exactly what it is. But something is coming. So we are active on that space. So, so So now this slide pretty much explains roughly the same story, but with a different dimension. So looking at these main markets, not from F-Secure offering. So internet security would be the large industry. The privacy is the new fast growth industry, and the digital home maybe even a bit further on the line. For what comes to market sizes, so this internet security, we said it's about 6 billion. Interestingly there, the big Symantec in US, they are in decline. So they are reporting declines in this business, whereas most other folks are still growing. And there is no official information about it. As an example, now as McAfee has been acquired by Intel, so they are not reporting this separately. But in some industry events, McAfee executives are telling that when analysts are asking how their performance is here, Symantec is in declining, so McAfee is saying that they are performing significantly better than Symantec, but that's all they say. And then most folks are interpreting that McAfee, being the second biggest in this game, is still growing. And then this privacy market and an encryption, so new vendors and a big kind of a household analyst companies like Gartner, they are not yet giving their market estimates for that. But there are various sources that you can look at. You see like how much you know of certain companies making revenues, and then you can draw some conclusion how much certain companies are managing to monetize these mobile apps through app stores, etc. So, and then there are some, say, maybe smaller or different analyst houses than Gartner who are giving their views on the market size, etc. So really depending on the guy you talk to, you get to a number between 300 million to a billion, but a fast growing market. And looking at again the drivers, so I think on this privacy space, so how we see it is like people want tools. People are getting more and more annoyed with the fact that once you go online, there are just tons and tons of companies profiling you, tracking you, and there's nothing you can do about it. And we want to give our customers a choice that there would be tools that you say, no, I don't want to be tracked. I don't want to be profiled. And some go even extra mile. They say that, hey, there is this cloud is all cool. It's very good that I put all my stuff to cloud, be it Dropbox or whatnot. But then the next day you read some new WikiLeaks or Edward Snowden story that, again, some American authorities went in and looked at some of your data. They are, of course, after the terrorist or whatnot, there's always the good cause, but people are getting annoyed that, no, it's my data. You can't look at it. And people are getting annoyed that you post your bicycle photos to the cloud, and suddenly you see that, hey, now I'm getting a lot of bicycle ads. Oh, interesting. So the world is changing. This definitely, I think, 3, 4, 5 years ago wasn't much of a topic, but it is. This awareness and demand for this is increasing fast. So this is how we see that the consumer security market at large has been moving forward, and what has it meant for F-Secure and to our portfolio. So we go back to early 2000, and maybe 2013 was maybe the one of the last years when this was still primarily a PC internet security, PC antivirus game for us. And then we went on and started to enroll our solution to protect not just your PC, but all your devices. And now if we look at here, this is the next step with F-Secure Safe, which is really the main product still today, driving revenues and driving profits. So expanding that to your entire digital home. I'll be talking a bit more what sort of things this digital parenting means. And here you see these new offerings like F-Secure Freedom for privacy, and then we have a product called F-Secure Key. We are not talking so much about that. We are seeing this a bit more of a maybe an adjacent feature even for Safe. So we plan to kind of package it firmly with Safe. But what F-Secure Key in this identity management space does is that it helps you to manage your passwords. Very, very simple. For consumers, for people, this means that if you are a customer of LinkedIn and you are a customer of Facebook and you are a customer of all sorts of online services, be it 10 or be it 20 or be it 30 of those. And then what we see, what we hear about the news that today eBay was hacked and some 100 million customer data was stolen. And then we hear same about the some Addison, Mashley, Ashley, or whatever those websites are. And the real problem for many of us is that if we are using many of these online services, most of us kind of think that, again, I need to create an account for Amazon. I need to create an account for LinkedIn. I need to create an account for Facebook. And the list goes on and on. And what most of us do is that to keep it convenient, you have one very good password that you use everywhere, because there's no way that you go and remember 20 or 30 or 50. And then the problem starts to happen when a guy like eBay gets hacked and you were a subscriber or customer for LinkedIn. And then what the bad guy does first, hey, I now got your credentials from eBay. Let's see if this guy was dumb enough that he's using the same set of credentials on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter. If you do, he's got your entire digital life. Now with product like F-Secure Key, we help you to safeguard against that. So Key kind of creates super long, super cumbersome passwords across these different services, and you just remember one password that you use to identify yourself to this product, and then this product does all the hassle on your behalf. So I just wanted to very briefly explain what that does, although our main efforts, the growth drivers, the profit drivers, would be much more on the F-Secure Safe and F-Secure Freedom side, and also this digital home protection side that we are not yet talking about in detail. New market opportunities anyways. Now this deep dives a bit more to this F-Secure Safe. So this is the new home management dashboard that we are shipping with our first operators as we speak. This takes the game to the totally new level. This is no longer that, okay, your PC is protected, you're all good. That's all there is. Here you see a family. There would be an Anne-Marie. He has a PC, Galaxy Tab, another PC, whatnot. These are her devices. And he sees that this device is protected. This has installed F-Secure product, but the color indicates that there's perhaps something wrong. Maybe you should check the updates or whatnot. This doesn't have any protection at all. So this is Anne-Marie, and then you roll the dice and then goes Ted, and then you here see what Ted has, etc. So this is how we are expanding this, not just to you, your PC, but to your family. And the story goes on. So how I use it as an example, some of you may find this a pretty good use case, or some of you may not. But I use this in this expanded family fashion. So if I log in to my F-Secure Safe, my circle here is, there would be me, there are the devices of my wife, there are maybe a device or devices of my daughter, and then there is a PC of my dad. So this is what we call security goes social. So we are allowing people to expand their kind of the family concept beyond protecting your PC. And in some countries this resonates extremely well. Some countries still think that, oh damn, this is the next best thing since sliced bread. And operators love this, because operators are after the home. They are not trying to make a deal just with you, but they try to get your whole home. And if you, especially if you looked fixed line operators, it's most cases there's just one subscription to your home. It's not that you are same time a subscriber for Elisa and Sonera and DNA. There's one, and they love this. And we are now rolling out this to our operator partners. And this is one of the vehicles that we believe that will help us to continue looking at this as a very, very healthy business for F-Secure. Then now I'm moving on to freedom. So we are launching a new, I think, very, very intriguing, very cool, very exciting feature with freedom in October. We call it Tracker Mapper. And earlier I explained how the value proposition in this privacy space is not against viruses and all that, but it's about protecting you against privacy violations, giving you tools to manage and control your online privacy. And this tool now visualizes that. It shows that you go to a website and you open this tool and it shows you that now you go to Iltalehti and you see, holy cow, there's 22 companies now tracking me. These 22 companies are putting their profiling hooks on you, which means that then you go to some other website, so somehow magically the ads follow you wherever you go. And even furthermore, you go to some airline websites and these hooks are on you. If you don't buy the ticket on that minute, you'll go to the very same website tomorrow. Somehow magically, the price is not the same. And it's not that the price is increased generally. They increased for you because they knew that after you visited that airline website, you went to some other airline websites, which means that now you're coming back. Those airline guys are clever. They know that, okay, he's coming back, likely to buy now. We want to give our customers better understanding what's out there, what this tracking and profiling means in practice. And then if you so will, with our products, you can take action. You can turn the product on, which makes you invisible, untrackable. You can't be profiled. This is what we want to tell our customers. We are very, very excited. This is so eye-opening, and you should really get it. So it's going to be shipping in October, and this is something that nobody else has. Nobody. This is wow. Our engineering teams, they worked long hours and long days, and a lot of thinking is behind this concept, a lot of really cool technologies. And if we are looking at our competitive edge in general, so summarizing a little bit of that, so for what comes to F-Secure Safe and Freedom, so really the operator channel is a monstrous opportunity for F-Secure. Through our 200 operator partners, we have access to about 1.5 billion consumers. And we believe that this product like Freedom, which is a new, this is a big opportunity for us to tap into the growth with the operator channel. With Safe, as you heard from Christian, it's harder because the market for the PC security, that is not really a growth market for anybody. But we believe that there is a lot of good business still available. We'll be driving good profits for F-Secure. And an example like on the freedom for the operator channel, so we haven't announced this before, but this is public because this particular operator is now live with the service, so this is not kind of under any NDA. You can go and see it yourselves. The biggest cable operator in the planet, one of the biggest operators overall in the planet, Comcast, we made a deal with Freedom. They are now live offering Freedom to their customers. And they are building a nationwide Wi-Fi network. And as one of the attributes with Freedom, not just tracking protection and anti-profiling at all, that is that it's encrypting the traffic. And a lot of times once you use open Wi-Fis, it's very easy to hack into those at the coffee shops. So Comcast gonna be stepping up a game and telling that they're gonna be offering this cool product to their customer base. further on the key differentiators, so operator business model and operator channel capabilities, that's very unique with F-Secure. It's not just like any other channel. It takes certain skills, certain technical capabilities that you can drive your products through operator channel. You need to integrate their business logic to their provisioning models, and in that game we are the best in the planet, clearly. We continue winning the best protection test wins with our PC security product, Safe. And I talked about the family management that we think is pretty cool. And now with Freedom, super excited about the best user experience, the tracker mapper, cloud security, all the intelligence with Freedom is now in the cloud. The client has a, I think, very compelling and cool user interface, but the client software that you install to your PC or iPhone, your tablet, whatnot, that's pretty stupid client. It doesn't do much. All the intelligence to track or stop tracking or profiling and encrypting, all that, everything is in the cloud. And last, there's no ads. Many of the competitors with Freedom in this privacy space, they are financing their business. Their business model is ads-based. And for some of you, it's like, I don't care. And the some of you is that, this is kind of a funny. These guys are giving me this privacy product, and then they are monetizing this, probably selling my data so that you can show me ads. So it's a weird equation. So, but they have probably good reasons to do so, but we are not entertaining that avenue now. And you see the competitors, very different here. Some similarities like AVG, and here is also an Avast, which is one of the pretty good antivirus companies. So a couple of examples how the internet security players are also expanding to privacy. But there are also the privacy specialists like Anchor3 is probably a market leader in that space. And then some performance figures. So we are very, very satisfied this one. That this shows that the blue is the old product and the orange is the new product. So we are shifting our customer base from old PC security product to this multi-device Safe. So that's one thing that helps with our technology synergies. Probably the more important thing here is that what the red bar shows, that we are getting better price point for the new technology versus the old one. This is not just a kind of a ever increasing arm race to give a new product, but there's nothing happening for your business. So we are managing to defend our prices very well, which is extremely important because this is the profit engine for F-Secure. And we have a very steady outlook here, and we believe that we are not the operator channel alone, but in conjunction with our direct consumer business that we are predominantly driving in Nordics, we are outperforming here the market, which was a low single-digit growth. And now with Freedom, so we continue doing a good job on increasing the downloads, and our conversion is improving. In direct consumer business, the business model is that you download the first free version, and then after 14 days, 30 days, you upgrade to a premium. And that conversion is steadily improving. And that is obviously the economic engine there, because we are not trying to optimize and maximize just the download volume. We would be doing that if this was ads funded, because then your monetization is just get as many customers in as you can. Conversion is improving all the time. And many of the major partners like Comcast, another one, Best Buy, you all know Best Buy. This is not the mother Best Buy in USA, but this is their close cousin in Canada. So they are now starting to sell Freedom. We never accessed guys like Best Buy with our old portfolio. It was always like, hey, it's pretty much the same as Simon. Again, they are there and you are there, so do your thing in Finland. Now we are entering these monstrous opportunities, Comcast and the Best Buy with Freedom. So key initiatives, continue growing with safe operator channel, more difficult, but direct consumer, we see big opportunities. We are, by the way, pretty boldly saying that our aim is to become market leader in the Nordics for what comes to that. We are probably today number two or number three after Symantec and Kaspersky, and we are really at least kicking Kaspersky's butt, throwing them out from many of the major retailers and so forth. Freedom, market entry, volumes, full leverage of the operator channel. Just imagine if that all 200 operators or even 50 of them will start selling Freedom. Big opportunity. New partner acquisition, Best Buy, and then is the e-commerce efficiency. Digital home, you'll hear more about it in a couple of months. A couple of examples. So on the operator channel, I took a case from Virgin, one of the biggest operators in UK. So a while back, we kicked out a competitor, one of the big antivirus companies there. So we continue winning these key partnerships. But I would say that even more importantly, because we have 200 operators, it's not like we need more. They are driving with F-Secure brand. Many of the operators are doing that with their own brand, like Telia Sonera Security, powered by F-Secure. It's like Intel inside with the HPPC. Virgin is going all in F-Secure. Proud to partner with you guys. That will drive our brand, will help also our corporate business. And digital parenting that I talked about, they are really taking that as the key themes with some families. And I think this is a pretty cool example of from Freedom, what types of new partners we are getting our hands into. Mad Croc, you know, the energy drink. They have just announced a game, a Mad Croc game, to drive their brand, to drive community for Mad Croc. They are releasing a biggest ever e-game tournament, winning prize, 100,000. Now, what does that mean for F-Secure? Our freedom is bolted into the game. So you can make your crocodile stronger with armor if you get freedom. So it's an example of cool new innovative partnerships what we are capable of doing in these new industries. They are aiming for tens of millions customers or players for this Mad Croc game. Subscriber growth for freedom, safe, profitable growth, and entering market for this really interesting digital home security space. So that's about all I had.
Samu, you could stay here for a while. We didn't schedule a Q&A here, but I was thinking before Mikko could also come here and start setting up the machine, but before we let him distract us, if there are some questions regarding the consumer business, now would be the perfect time, because I'm sure then after Mikko you will not even remember. So now is the chance while Mikko is still preparing.
Kimmo Stenvall. About the telecom operators, can you name maybe for your top five operators that are selling your products or the most subscribers are in your customer base?
I'm not sure if we've ever given names like what would be the top five, but given that there's about two or more than 200 of them, so it really would be the biggest of the partners that we have. So if you take DNA from Finland, and then if you take that we have a Telefonica group in whole Latin America, so I think you can draw a conclusion who is bigger for us. Just an illustrative example. So, but we are not giving that operator-specific kind of information. DNA is a good company, by the way, so.
Okay. If none of you has any questions, then I could ask Samu, in 5 years, do you think consumers, are they willing to pay for anything anymore?
I think the bar is being raised all the time, so they are really pretty good products out there today for free, and you could have that discussion like 5, 6, 7 years ago, like when the free PC AV guys entered the game, and still I think a lot of folks understand that there's really no such thing as freelance. So either you really go and tolerate the all-in profiling and tracking and ads and your ass is theirs, or then you don't want that exactly. So I think some of the domains here definitely will continue being the premium ones where consumers pay.
Okay. If there's one more question. Okay.
Matti Riikonen, Carnegie. There was the slide performance in 2015. I don't know which slide number, but where you showed the freedom downloads on a cumulative basis and monthly conversion. I'm just wondering whether these are scaled in the same way, so that is it really so that the conversion rate is about 90% of cumulative
downloads?
No, they're not. So the scale is different.
The scale is different between the two numbers there. So.
Okay.
Plus 90% conversion would be pretty good. I give you that.
Yeah. It just doesn't show the
good,
scale here.
Good to check.
Okay.
Anything else? All right.
Thank you, Samu, and then Mikko. The floor is yours.
All right. So good day to all of you from me as well. I am Mikko Hyppönen, and I'm the oldest employee in this company. Risto hired me in 1991 as a developer, and after more than 24 years, I'm still here. And I'm technically the oldest because Risto doesn't work here. He's just the chairman of the board. So, and over those 24 years, we've seen a pretty wild ride. I mean, of course, the company has changed from a small startup to where we are today. But even bigger change has been in the threat landscape. Well, of course, early on, we weren't only a security company. We focused on security during the 1990s. But for the last 15 years or a little bit more, we've been focused on security alone. And even during that time, the shift in who we are actually fighting has been quite remarkable. For the first years, as we started building antivirus products and analyzing malware, we were basically fighting kids. Teenager boys who were writing viruses, and their motivation was fun or challenge. They did it because they could. And when we look at the enemy today, we don't have that kind of enemy left at all. All the players, all the actors have a very good reason to do what they're doing. They're motivated by something bigger than just fun or challenge. And I strongly believe that if we want to be able to provide security solutions to our partners and our customers, we have to understand the enemy better than anyone else. Because you have no hope in trying to build defenses if you don't actually understand who you are fighting. And the enemies are different. It's quite different to fight an organized crime gang or to fight a governmental player or hacktivist gang. So let's have a look. Who's actually hacking? Who are the hackers? Well, Tommy mentioned quite rightly that we are. We have quite a few professional hackers that we have in our payroll. People who do pretty much exactly the same thing as our enemies do, except that we don't break the law. Whatever we do with permission. If we are invited to come to your network and see if we can break it, and then we break it, of course that isn't illegal. But the way we break it isn't frankly that different from the way the criminals do it or other actors do it. And those we call white hat hackers, like these guys. This is Charlie Miller and Chris Valasek. These guys are hackers, but they're the good kind of hackers. These guys made the headlines in July with the Chrysler hack, where they managed to hack a Jeep Grand Cherokee and take over the controls as well as the brakes of the car, which caused eventually Chrysler to do a recall of 1.4 million cars. Not here in Finland, though. The system they were targeting required the car to be online using a SIM card from the operator Sprint, and Sprint only operates in the United States. So the recall, 1.4 million car recall, only affected US-based cars. Then we have people who do break the law, like hacktivists. Basic, or the most well-known example would be Anonymous. Anonymous, which is actually fairly well and alive even here in Finland. And these guys break the law, but they don't do it for their own benefit. They don't make money with their attacks. They get nothing for themselves. The reason for their attacks is typically protest or maybe a political motive. And this means that the targets typically are well picked. They don't just target random companies. They have a beef with a company. And then they target that company to settle the score or to teach them a lesson or to make them embarrassed, something like that. But the key differentiator here is that these guys don't steal to make themselves rich. If they do steal to make themselves rich, then they belong to the next category, which is organized crime or online organized crime. Money making with malware started in the first years of this century, like a little over 10 years ago. Today we see guys like him. This is Mihai Ghiata from Bucharest in Romania. We see guys like him making millions with attacks like ransom trojans or keyloggers or banking trojan or data theft, identity theft, and so on. Some of the techniques we see being used to make money are very creative. Like, for example, when Bitcoin came to the market space, it very quickly came to our radar because of criminals who were using botnets, infected computers, to do Bitcoin mining for them, which is a really creative attack. Like, you take over computers, but you don't steal anything from the computers. You just use their power to create your own supercomputer, which you then use to make money by mining for virtual currencies. Pretty creative. So money making continues to be the biggest problem from our lab's point of view. The largest amount of samples that we see coming into our systems is coming from organized criminal gangs. On a typical day, we get, well, on any day, we get hundreds of thousands of samples for analysis into our systems. Majorities of the new samples are new versions or new variants of different kinds of crimeware, where the outcome is to make money. Then we have the governments. And personally, to me, this has been the biggest surprise of my career. When I started analyzing viruses spreading on 5 1/4 floppy inch disks, I could have never imagined that one day we will be analyzing malware which is developed and deployed by governments, even by democratic Western governments. Even cases where democratic Western governments manufacture and deploy malware against other friendly democratic Western governments. And this is all happening today. It's almost like science fiction would have become reality. But this is a real issue. And then the last group is extremists or terrorists. I did a fairly long study in the offensive cyber capabilities of real-world terror groups little less than 3 years ago. There, my main focus at the time was Al-Qaeda. ISIS was still, or Islamic State was still, pretty much invisible at the time. And 3 years ago, the outcome of the research was that we don't have to worry about this yet. All the extremist groups which were online at the time were using the internet to recruit, to spread propaganda for communications, including encrypted communications. Al-Qaeda runs their own encrypted network, for example. But I did finish the study by saying that even though we have no clear threats at the moment, it's also clear that this situation isn't going to get better, it's going to get worse. And that's exactly what's been happening over these 3 years, especially with ISIS, which really is the only extremist group out there today which has credible offensive cyber capability. Now, we don't yet have cases where real terror attacks would have been done with cyber attacks. Most of the cases they've done so far has just been hacking computers, not trying to kill people with their stuff. But it's not completely impossible. So quite a range of different attackers. And of course, this is still only part of the picture. We have the outliers, attackers which don't belong to any of these groups. Let me give you a prime example. Ashley Madison. Who hacked Ashley Madison? Well, we don't know who it was, but we know quite a bit about the attacker or attackers. They breached the security of Ashley Madison's system. They stole their customer database. Little over 2 months ago, they told the management of the company that we've stolen your customer database. And by the way, we also hate you guys. The reason why we stole your database is that we want you to stop operations. We want you to shut down your services. We want you to go out of business. And they tell this to this Canadian company with 40 million users on their website. And the demand was that if you don't stop all operations, we will publish this list of 36 million customer email addresses and customer sexual preferences and customer home addresses and so on. And Ashley Madison didn't fall. They didn't stop their operations. So 31 days after the threat was made, they did exactly what they threatened and published the list. 36.5 million customer records. Sure, many of them were duplicates. Sure, there's lots of bots and stuff, but there's still tens of millions of real people in that database. And it's almost impossible to understand just how large, you know, how big something like that is. So let me just try to illustrate it by just dumping these email addresses. So this is the Ashley Madison database. That's the users. And if you pay attention, there's a number here. So this is user number 3000, user number 4000. And this will go on until 36,500,000. If we leave it scrolling, it's going to be still scrolling there in the evening. All right? It's a lot of users. It's a massive, massive breach. And it's also a very global breach. Here's a map of the home addresses of the Ashley Madison customers. For curiosity, there's 16,962.fi addresses in there. So obviously the attacker here didn't belong to any of those groups. They weren't interested in making money. They weren't a governmental player. They weren't an extremist. They had a beef with the company and they wanted to destroy the company. They didn't like. Why? We don't know. Maybe it was somebody who had his spouse cheat on him or her on Ashley Madison and they wanted revenge. Maybe it was a ex-employee who had a crutch. Maybe it was a current employee. And if it was a current employee, that means that maybe Ashley Madison wasn't hacked at all. Maybe the whoever did this had access to all this data. Maybe he was an IT admin. Maybe he broke nothing. We don't know. But a very, very high profile case, which has, of course, had many other organizations pay attention to their security requirements. Couple more words about the GPAC. This is the car in question, the car Charlie Miller and Chris Wallasek hacked, a Jeep Grand Cherokee. And the important thing here is that they did not modify the car. They could do this to any Jeep. And they could themselves be anywhere in the world. The Jeep has to be in USA because of the Sprint SIM that has to be in the dashboard for this to work. But the way they hacked it is that they connected remotely to the radio slash navigation system, which had internet connectivity. Then they were able to reflash the system with their own code, which then allowed them to jump from the navigation systems to the CAN bus, which is the bus inside the car, which controls everything. And you can today imagine today's car pretty much like a data center on four wheels. There's quite a bit of sensors and chips and code running a modern car. So what exactly did they do? I'll play you a video clip illustrating this.
After their stunt on the highway, Chris and Charlie still wanted to show me a couple of other tricks. Below a certain speed, they can control the Jeep steering as long as it's in reverse, pop its locks, mess with the speedometer, and, of course, disable the brakes. Okay, hold on tight. Hold on.
Scary stuff. Of course it's scary stuff. However, I'm not really worried about Charlie and Chris. So this here is Charlie, this here is Chris. Because these are security researchers. They're not interested in killing anybody or disabling brakes in cars in wide scale. They want to get these things fixed. In fact, they told Chrysler about their research in February. They told Chrysler in February that we found this, this, and this. And we're going to go public with this information. And we're going to tell the world about these things in the Black Hat Conference in Las Vegas in August. So you have 6 months' time to fix this. And that's exactly what Chrysler did. Chrysler issued a fix 2 weeks before they went public with the information. So the system worked. The system worked here. Interestingly, 2 weeks ago, Charlie, who used to work at Twitter, and Chris, who used to work at IOActive, both left their employees because they got a new job. Both of them were hired by Uber, the taxi company. And when I heard about this, I was a bit surprised. So I sent my congratulations to the guys, and then I like went wandering around on Uber's recruitment pages. Like, why is Uber hiring these guys? Why is a goddamn taxi company hiring two arguably like top-ranking car hackers in the world? And then when I was looking at Uber recruitment pages, I saw that they actually had, well, they had around 400 open positions. And you would think a company like Uber would be hiring like drivers and sales and marketing guys. That's what I thought. Well, it turns out they're mostly hiring engineers, including FPGA designers or machine learning specialists. So we're speaking about AI, artificial intelligence, and FPGA chips being designed. They have 12 different engineering stations in different parts of the world, including one in Lithuania, one in Milan. Uber. I was really surprised about this. And of course, what's the takeaway from this? What is Uber doing? Why are they hiring these guys? To get rid of the drivers. Of course, to build a self-driving car. Can't be anything else. And I'll tell you, I can't wait for self-driving cars to be reality. I've done enough sitting in traffic jams in different parts of the world in my life that I'd be more than happy to change our traffic from what it looks like today to completely automated cars, which means traffic would look like this. Everything would flow, and even the people in the traffic would know that the cars won't hit them. I mean, I can't wait for this, right? Of course, the only problem is that you'll be getting a heart attack every 15 seconds. But when cars drive themselves, that's what it's going to look like. And there's a deeper thing behind all of this. The deeper importance, which is reflected in our work. I gotta pause that because you can't listen to me while that's playing. And that is that those of us who work with computer security, well, we used to be thinking that we are securing computers. What we do is that we secure computers. Well, those are computers today. We have lights in this building because of computers and software. The water coming out of the tap is controlled by computers and software. So working with computer security very much today means not just securing computers, but securing our infrastructure, securing our society, because all of these things rely on computers and rely on software, and they have to be secured. Applies to cars. Applies to planes. You all saw news earlier this year in June or May about plane hacking. Those cases were all basically coming from one security researcher, a guy called Chris Roberts, who was doing security research on planes. And quite stupidly, he actually did testing on live planes while he was flying on those planes. He tried to prove that if you can actually connect to the in-flight entertainment system on planes, you know, the seats which have a display on them, you can jump from the in-flight entertainment system to the control systems and the avionics of the plane itself. And he actually proved that it can be done by doing that on live planes while he was a passenger on those planes. Which is, so, of course, interesting because how do you actually do that? Like, how do you actually connect to the network of the in-flight entertainment system? Well, I can show you how you do it. I took this photo myself on a KLM flight from Amsterdam to Helsinki. I was sitting in 4C, aisle seat. So this is seat 4A, and that's the box for the in-flight entertainment system, under seat 3A. So the way you connect to it is that you open up the box, you take out four screws, the lid comes off, then you find a PCB circuit board which has connectors on it. None of the connectors are standard, but if you solder your own connector, then you can connect to it, and it will give you DHCP, and you can get an IP address from there, and then you can start scanning the network, and you will actually find a firewall which is separating the in-flight entertainment system from the avionics network. And if you know the firewall password, then you're good to go. And that's basically what Chris Roberts was proving. And you know what this is? Well, this is the Internet of Things. Typically, when you hear the term Internet of Things, you think about toasters connected to the internet, or, I don't know, smart watches, or microwave ovens and washing machines. Well, it's that as well. But it's also the fact that cars and planes are online. It's also the fact that factories and all kinds of processing, including logistics, are online. The Internet of Things definitely isn't something which is in the future. It's already here, has been here for quite a while. And the thing that worries me about IoT security is that for many of these devices, security is not the main selling point. It's not the defining feature. It's especially obvious when you go looking at appliances. When you go buying a washing machine, you're buying a washing machine. This security, online security of the washing machine isn't really a selling point, yet it's online. And in appliance business, price is crucial. And this means that these companies, which are building all these devices somewhere in China and South Korea, invest as little as possible for the security features. And we can partially see this by just going online today and starting to scan public IP addresses with tools like we've built here at F-Secure, or actually that Ensense built, which are now part of our repertoire. We have tools which will scan the net and look for devices and fingerprint them, try to figure out what they are. Of course, you'll mostly find computers and routers, but then you'll also find, yes, washing machines and microwave ovens and coffee machines and lifts. You'll even find systems like these. This is some sort of a power generator, right now generating 14.6 kilowatts of power, and this is online, with a public IP address, with no authentication, with no password. This is some kind of a factory system somewhere in Sweden, online with no password. This is an Italian power generator, 408 kilowatts this time, online with no password. This is a dam system from Denmark, and so on. Some of you might recognize this food processing plant. I believe they make Kallen Mätitahna. So what's the risk scenario here? Who's going to hack these? Who's going to hack power generators and dams and food processing plants? And that's a good question. Who's going to hack a microwave oven or a light bulb? And then there has to be a reason for the attackers to do their attacks. And it's easy to see that you could do a lot of damage by connecting to systems like these and doing modifications, which then will lead us back to what we were discussing earlier about extremists and about guys belonging into terrorist groups gaining enough capability that they could actually start affecting critical infrastructure around us. And this is a scary thought. Groups like these are scary because they are the only ones willing to do the kinds of attacks that no one else is willing to do. One of the guys who was among ISIS ranks, being one of their main hackers, is this guy, Junaid Hussain, British citizen. We were actually tracking Junaid around 3 years ago when he was in UK and doing hacking into voicemail of Tony Blair and doing website defacement, stuff like that. Then he disappeared and later reappeared with a new name and new identity from Syria after he had joined ISIS. He started calling himself Abu Hussain al-Britani, and he was tweeting threats to US and UK governments as part of ISIS. And the reason why I'm using the term was is that Junaid Hussain is no longer with us. He died, we believe, he died 2 weeks ago. And this was in a drone strike by the US military in northern Syria as Junaid Hussain was in a car traveling from the city of Raqqa to another city in northern Syria. And I believe this is the first time US Army has used a drone strike to kill a hacker. There's a phrase for you which could be straight out of a science fiction book. US Army used a drone strike to kill a hacker. But that's what happened 2 weeks ago. Which I believe gives some kind of an idea about how seriously US government takes threats like these. For a good reason. Now, before I got on stage, someone was speaking about freedom and about the need to secure the privacy of our users. And one of the crucial things related to our privacy, of course, is cloud. And let me tell you a secret. There is no cloud. There's no cloud. It's just other people's computers. When you put stuff into cloud, you just put your stuff into other people's computers. So what do those computers look like? Well, they look like this. So there's your cloud. You can see the clouds, right? This is Hamina data center for Google. One of the most secretive places I know of, actually. I'm fairly well connected with geeks and nerds in Finland. I don't know anybody who would have been there. Not a single guy. But that's where Google runs Gmail and YouTube and Google Maps and Google Search and things like that. And that's how Google is able to distill profiles of us, the users, into actionable data, which makes so much money that Google is right now actually investing more than $2 billion every quarter into their data centers. Google is putting more than $2 billion 4 times a year only into their data centers, which is just ridiculous. Like, no one else is investing that much money into their infrastructure. Google is. And if you think about the bigger picture, that Google services are free. You pay nothing to make a search. You pay nothing to use Gmail. Yet they invest so much money. You would think that a company like Google would be going bankrupt. But of course, they're not going bankrupt. They're very profitable. They made $16 billion in profit last year, which just shows you how valuable our data is. And that's one of the reasons why monitoring users by Facebook and Twitter and Google has become such a big business. And it's not just these companies which provide services for free which do it. This is IKEA.fi. When you go to IKEA and load the front page, if you're using a tool which will show you different kind of analytic trackers that are part of the IKEA front page, you'll find that they have 49 different trackers on the front page. 49 different analytical tools or tracker tools loading from there. And this has two different problems in it. First problem are the privacy implications, the fact that we are being profiled closer and closer every year. The second problem is a much more practical one, which is that your browser isn't just loading HTML files and images from one server. It's actually connecting to 49 different servers to load JavaScript and execute it. And this makes things slower. This actually this reminds me of something. I believe that was a Wii 32 bis handshake. The tracking of end users is recreating the dial-up experience. That's what's happening. Sometimes it feels like we're going backwards with the developments that we're building on the web. Well, let me finish by speaking a little bit about the governmental action. And this is timely for several reasons. The very first governmental malware we ever found was in 2003, so 12 years ago. That was from China. And during those 13 years, we've seen a whole range of actors getting into this picture. Malware being written by the Russians, by the Americans, by India, by Pakistan, by North Korea, by Iran, and so on. And especially the tension between the United States and China is picking up speed. President Obama actually addressed this earlier this week, 5 days ago, on the anniversary of 9/11. He was actually at Fort Meade. This is inside the NSA headquarters, where Obama was speaking with the cyber troops operating from within Fort Meade. Let me play you one of his answers to one of the soldiers in the audience.
And so, for example, I'm going to be getting a visit from President Xi of China, a state visit here coming up in a couple of weeks. We've made very clear to the Chinese that there are certain practices that they're engaging in that we know are emanating from China and are not acceptable. And, you know, we can choose to make this an area of competition, which I guarantee you we'll win if we have to.
We can choose to make this a competition, basically hacking competition between China and United States. And if that's going to happen, then President Obama assures that the United States will win. That's how confident he is. And there's another timely thing which has affected our view of the world regarding governmental action. Because this company was hacked in January. This is the headquarters of Kaspersky Lab, one of our competitors in Moscow. Their network was breached by an attacker which we believe to be the Israeli government. So the Israel government breaches the security of a security company in Russia. And they didn't breach their network to use it as a vector to gain access to their customers. They breached their network because they were interested in Kaspersky's R&D. They wanted to know about their detection capabilities and how they try to detect governmental malware, very much the kind of governmental malware that they were hit with themselves. When this became public, well, we were running around in circles for a couple of days here at F-Secure, as you might imagine. And we went through all of our own systems to figure out whether we've had any breaches. Of course, we've been targeted throughout the years many, many times. And we didn't find anything. Which either means that we don't have anybody in our networks, or if there's somebody in our networks, they're so good that we can't find them. But I hope we don't have anybody in our networks. Tomorrow we will be publishing this report. It's a white paper, around 40 pages, which details research that we've been doing for quite a while now, trying to investigate a large family of malware that we call the Dukes. We've recently found two new members of this family, and with the research that we're publishing tomorrow, we are providing a timeline of an attack which started in 2008, continues all the way until today. Targets of these attacks are typically ministries or defense players around the world. And we believe this attack is launched by the Russian government. So these are the kinds of actors that we are seeing today. From the criminals who try to make money, to activists who want to protest, to governments who use their attacks for intelligence gathering and surveillance and espionage, all the way to extremists who might be willing to do the kinds of attacks we haven't yet seen. Thank you very much.
Go. Thank you, Mikko. We have some time for questions now before we close the session with the closing remarks from Risto. So any questions now? That's the perfect chance. Go ahead.
Rauhat, I'm from Danske Bank. So how do you stay ahead? I mean, you're fighting against governments, organized crime, so, and you are only 1,000 employees approximately here at F-Secure. So what's your magic?
It's a race. And you're not always leading in this race. That's quite clear. We use different kind of mechanisms to stay current on who we are fighting. Regarding criminal elements, we've had for years and years active investigations where we follow what these guys are doing, find the forums where they discuss with each other, typically nowadays in the hidden networks or in the Tor network, where they buy and sell malware, buy and sell stolen goods, buy and sell stolen credit card information. And by behaving as one of them, having undercover identities which have been active in that space for years and years, so that they're sort of trusted parties in that network, we gain visibility, which works very well when you want to see visibility to the criminal part. In the governmental part, it's a little bit different. It's an area where it's hard to have global visibility, and it's hard to be able to build products that actually protect against APT attacks or governmental attacks unless you actually work with the cases hands-on yourself. And that's exactly the background, one of the main reasons why we went with the Ensense acquisition. That's exactly the kind of skills that we got. Other questions?
Also, I think if you have questions now for Christian as well, that there would be some time for that, but depends on you. Okay, what I might steal one more question.
Sure.
You've mentioned several threat trends and phenomena. What do you find personally most worrying, scaring?
Well, sometimes I worry that we've already lost the war on privacy. What I mean by that is that we already have a generation of internet users who've grown up to sort of assume that everything online is free. Like, you don't pay for anything online with real money. Like, in the real world, if you bought a magazine, you have to pay with real money. In the online world, you don't pay with money. And they might understand that you pay with something else, that you pay with privacy, you pay with your data, but they just assume that that's the way it's supposed to be. And if that really indeed is the case, it's very hard to change that anymore. So maybe the times of privacy for us as a species are behind us. There still, of course, are lots of practical things that people want to protect, even if they don't really believe that they should be paying for anything with any other means. Like, you know, if you use a Wi-Fi network, you still want to encrypt your traffic, even if you're not really worried about privacy. But I think there might be a mindset changing with the generation which don't remember the time before Google or before Wikipedia. And that generation is already out there. It's starting university right now.
Okay, not to end too negatively, what makes you hopeful? Something.
Well, I suppose the same generation also gives me hope. I mean, looking at where we are, well, just looking at Finland as a country, and looking at the startup scene here and how clever people we have growing up. In many ways, I'm glad that we, all of us here, we are the dinosaurs. We will soon be dying out, and the new generation will take over, and the new generation is going to be great.
That's a good way to end. Thank you, Mikko.
Yes?
There was one. Okay, online question. Can you, let's see if I can see it from here. Do I need to come there?
Can you...
Yes, it's here.
Esko, read it from...
Alan Cafford, how do you monetize your threat detection skills?
How do we monetize our threat detection skills? We monetize it by selling antivirus. That's the traditional way we've been doing it forever. We're very lucky in the sense that we saw early enough the need to automate malware analysis and threat hunting and threat detection capabilities. And we started building our backend systems, which are very sizable systems. I know they are sizable because I know quite a bit about the systems our competitors run. We started building ours 7 years ago, something like that. And the systems we run today can handle automatically, hands-free, the vast majority of cases that are found by our automatic detection systems every single day. So we actually actively go out to the net to hunt for new malware. So right now, at this very moment, we have around 450 servers which are pretending to be end users, surfing with old versions of Windows, with Internet Explorer, with Java enabled, and they surf porn sites and pirate sites and click on every link to get infected. And then when they get infected, we collect samples from those machines, which really aren't old Windows machines. And then we run them through our backend systems. And that gives us timely response to new malware. And that means we can protect users against malware infections, which means users will buy our detection capability in the form of security products.
Okay. One more question.
Artem Beleski from SEB. Coming to a freedom product and privacy topics in general, so what is, so to say, if you look at Google and Facebook, so it's definitely the way how they monetize on the operations, and basically they're not that happy about this kind of development. Have they already reacted to it in some sense, or is it still, so to say, a fairly small element, negative element to the operations?
I think much bigger headache for companies like Google and Facebook and others who make all their money with ad networks are ad blockers. And ad blocking has become a big headache for all ad networks already, much bigger than VPNs or the kinds of solutions we have. And now with iOS 9 coming out from Apple in a week or two, which actually has ad blocking built in by default, we're probably going to see some of the players take some sort of an action. But we haven't actually seen anything ourselves yet with Freedom.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now we will close this session. I will invite our founder and chairman of the board, Risto Siilasmaa, here to give his closing remarks. So Risto, the floor is yours.
Thank you. It's good to be back. It's 9 years since I have stood in front of this type of an audience in this particular company. And it's amazing to see some faces that I still remember from those 9 years back. Good to see that you have been persistent in following F-Secure. Instead of what Tapio wanted me to talk about, I'll talk about something completely different. So I'll talk a little bit about how our board is working, what the board is thinking. I'm basically bringing you greetings from our board, or a glimpse to the topics that we struggle with. But first of all, three key principles that we follow in the board. First of all, we always take the long-term view. We really are not optimizing for the short term. Some of you might want us to do that, because we would have great opportunities in increasing the profitability of the company in the short term, but at a cost in the long term. And we are focused on the long term. We always have been, and we always will be. So that's a given. We are looking for significant growth. We have failed at that over the last few years, but we continue to look for significant growth with a sustainable competitive advantage. The combination of those two. Not either or, but both, and only both. And we recognize that we will always win or lose through the people we hire. It's a people business. This is a creative business. So those three key principles should always be on the top of our minds. And then, of course, there are several global megatrends that we are all thinking about, you as well as we in F-Secure. We are wondering, what does the decline of the PC mean in the long term? Will the increasing importance of mobility continue growing? Where does it go? What do the app ecosystems mean in the long term? How about the ad-based monetization? Mikko mentioned Apple's new functionality in iOS 9, and there are other dynamics in the ad-based business models that are somewhat challenging for certain players. We have stayed away from that business model for various reasons, perhaps for the short term to the detriment of the company, perhaps for the long term for the right reasons. Time will tell. National security playing an increasingly important role in our business. And as a result of national security, also a fragmentation of the internet. Where will that go? And what does that mean for us? There are a number of other mega trends, but they all make us think about what is the right business mix for the company and what is the optimal allocation of people and funding to the businesses we have. And we are engaged in a number of businesses, as you well know. We're engaged in the corporate market with a direct relationship with our customers. The Ensense acquisition is a good example of that, or that business is a good example of that. We are very active in the SMB market through channel partnerships. We have a large number of partners around the world, mostly in Europe, that promote and sell our products and support our customers. We have a very large number of consumer customers through our web-based sales, through traditional channels, mostly in the Nordics, and through operators around the world. All these businesses share certain core technologies. They all share our brand and benefit from our brand, and they all share the security research that we do. So there's significant synergies between those businesses, but what is the right business mix right now and for the long term? And what is the right allocation of people and funding between those businesses? What is the right geographical mix? Are we the Nordic hero? Yes, we are. We are pretty much the only company of our type in the Nordics. Or not pretty much, we are the only company of our type in the Nordics. That needs to be a competitive edge for us. If especially the public sector makes rational decisions, which is often prevented by the regulations they work under, where they are forced to buy the cheapest product, even in our sector, as odd as it is, but if they make rational decisions, we have an edge. Are we the European champion? Well, absolutely. We want to be the European champion. We want to be the trusted player for European customers who really worry about their security. Can we be the global player that everybody can trust? Not everybody can trust the Americans, not everybody can trust the Russians, not everybody can trust the Chinese, but could everybody trust a Finnish company? And what is the national Finnish brand going to be in the digitalizing world? I believe there's an opportunity for all Finnish high-tech companies and Finland in nurturing and supporting the kind of a brand that Finland actually has an opportunity to create. Again, what is the right resource allocation geographically? That's of course an ongoing dynamic. You need to continuously make adjustments, but again taking the long-term view what is the right focus. And then, as we are engaged in a number of businesses, in a number of geographies, for a number of different customer segments, what is the right allocation into new products? We have some very exciting projects ongoing. Not all of them will see the light of the day at the end of the tunnel, as should be. Some of those projects will be cancelled before we launch, but that's why we need to have a number of them. Which ones will be launched? It's always an investment, always ties down our resources, it's always away from something else. But looking for significant growth with a sustainable competitive advantage for the long term also requires renewal. And we have very interesting opportunities on that front. So these are the type of things that the board is thinking about in the sort of strategic dimension. Of course, there's a lot of other things that the board spends its time on, but perhaps not of as much interest to this audience. I'd also be happy to take a couple questions if you have any.
Okay, so thank you, Risto, and also thank you for not following my notes. I'm sure this was much more interesting for the audience. We have some time for some questions, so if you have any now is the chance, and then I'll wrap up the thing.
Sami Sarkamies, Nordea Markets. You said that you have failed in some of the previous attempts to achieve this high growth. Has it been more of a function of execution, or have those plans been sort of false? What's your view?
You know, it's impossible in hindsight to really prove what would have happened if at any fork in the road in the past we would have taken a different turn, a different way. And I think we can improve on every part of our activities. In the cloud storage business, for example, I think we were a couple of years late, maybe 2-3 years late. But then by better execution, we would have been able to make more progress as well. It didn't end badly for us, but of course our aspirations were significantly higher. That's actually a good example of the kind of aspirations that we have. We are looking for a significant growth with a sustainable competitive advantage. And even in the cases where we feel we failed, we actually achieved very valuable technology and very valuable customer relationships, which turned out to have reasonable value even when we divested of that business. So absolutely we can improve on every part and should.
Yes, Antti Garasso from OP Wealth Management. We all know you have been quite busy personally during the past few years at the helm of Nokia and the many movements that you have done there. And this is a question I ask you when you joined Nokia board. And basically now looking back, do you feel that the F-Secure has got the sort of enough of your attention and attention to sort of be on top of changes happening also on the F-Secure's market, or if you could have been more on top of things here?
Well, we have a very good team in the company, and that's in the end the board's most important duty, not to manage the company, but to find the people, the team that can do that well. And I don't think we have spared any effort on that front. And while I have had lots of fun in Nokia, as you pointed out, F-Secure is always number one in my heart. So I don't see a possibility where I wouldn't have time for F-Secure. Of course, I have been full-time in Nokia, but many full-time CEOs have a board seat or a chairmanship on the side, and they can do that. So while I have been full time for extended periods of time, that's not the status quo, for example, right now. So as is always the case, one has busier times and less busy times, but there's always time for important things. And I don't know, you should ask these guys whether I have been here enough. I think they would all say that yes, he has been here enough.
Thank you.
Yes, and
that's typically the management's answer.
Yeah. And you can ask more questions when we now go for lunch next. So the discussion will continue over lunch. This was what we wanted to present to you today. I hope you enjoyed it. And we look forward to seeing you again when we publish our interim results in about a month. Thank you for joining us both here and online. And have a nice day, and thank you, and bye for now.